Good day, everyone, and welcome to tonight's, or today if you're in the US, event all about diffusion models. And this is part of the Diffusion Models class that Jono is creating. And today we've got a great lineup of speakers from Stability AI, from Meta, from Lambda Labs AI, and even from Hugging Face with our own Polly. And so if you've got burning questions about, you know, Stable Diffusion or the future of generative AI, please post them in the comments, and then we'll ask the speakers at the end of their talk. And my name is Lewis. I'm an engineer in the open source team at Hugging Face. And thanks to Jono, I'm slowly becoming a convert to diffusion models. And so I'm really excited by the course he's been developing. And so with that, I'll let him say a few words about it before we jump into our first speaker tonight, who is Devi Parikh.
So I won't spend too much time on the course, just to say that we're very excited. If you're here, I'm sure you're here because you've seen all of the fun things happening in the space of generative models and specifically diffusion models recently. And so especially when that was first picking up traction, there's been this big gap between, well, this is all new and exciting, but there's not that many people with the skills to really understand and dig in and build on this. And that is slowly starting to change. We're seeing more and more resources come out, but this course aims to also just boost that and fill in the gap and get you up to speed. So far, there's just a single unit out on the introduction to kind of build the groundwork and start getting some intuition for how these things work. But over time, we'll add more units on building up to more advanced models, digging into Stable Diffusion as a great example of some of the innovations in the space. And then hopefully over time, adding things like diffusion for audio, et cetera. That's the course. I'm also very excited about this event because we'll be hearing from a number of people who have some great expertise to share. And starting out, we have Devi Parikh, who is a research director at FAIR, the Fundamental AI Research Lab over at Meta. And she is also an associate professor, I believe, at the School of Interactive Computing at Georgia Tech. So Devi's here to talk to us about, I think, mostly the recent Make a Video project. But hopefully just more generally some thoughts about the space as well. So Devi, so great to have you here. Thank you for coming. I'll hand over to you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. All right. So I take it you can see my slides and you can hear me. So I am going to talk about make a video towards the end of the talk, but I'll also talk a little bit about some of the other work that we've been doing in multimodal generative models. And just to kind of prime my interest in this space. So the thing that I find exciting about these generative models is the potential that these tools have, the potential of using AI for augmenting human creativity, to give people more tools for creative expression, to express themselves in a way that's authentic to their voice. And so that's what I'm excited about. And so you'll probably see glimpses of that influence as I walk through these different pieces of work. So I'll start a little bit with images before I go to a video, and then also a little bit with audio. And so in images, we had this system called Make a Scene the thing that I was excited about was, in addition to text to image generation, it also let you sketch out the composition of the scene. So here I'm sketching out the sky and the grass and some mountains and things of that sort. And so this was not using diffusion models, this was using transformer-based models. And so at the time, there weren't a whole lot of tools that let you guide the image generation in this particular way. And so here you're seeing that the text description leads to these different images that have different visuals, but all have the exact same scene composition that you guided. And then with the same sketch, you can change the text, like a cactus on lush green grass in front of snow mountains on a sunny day with roses in the sky. And you get these different set of images with the same composition, but now they look different because the text was different. And so this level of control is something that I was quite excited about with this system. And so something that many of you may not realize is that Make a Scene was actually released before DALL-E 2. And so it was state of the art in image generation for an entirety of 10 days before DALL-E 2 happened. And then there was this whole sequence of Imogen and Party and many other models now, more recently Stable Diffusion and others in this space. And so here's a glimpse of some images that Make a Scene could generate. You see the sketch in the bottom left corner for many of these. And here you see the sketch in the middle. And so sort of having all of these sort of fantastical compositions in a way that you can drive them is what was exciting here. The way this model worked at a very high level is from input text, it first generated what the scene layout should look like, and then it generated the pixels that captured the appearance of that scene layout. And so this intermediate representation of the scene is what was interesting here. And interestingly, what we found is that this intermediate representation improves the quality of the image. So not only is it useful for control, where instead of the model predicting it, you can also provide it as input, but even in the setting where you're not providing it as input, it's optional. Even if you provide just text as input, the fact that the model is reasoning about this intermediate layout before it predicts the image, we found that that helps us get higher quality image generations without using a whole lot of data. So this was trained on a data set that was smaller than most other techniques and was all open source, by the way. And we had state-of-the-art in image generation at the time. And so here's just kind of a glimpse of the metrics and more of a qualitative comparison at the time. This was March of this year. Feels like a long time ago, but it wasn't that long ago, comparing to CogView and DALL-E 1 at the time and Glide and things of that sort. Here's another example of where these sketches can help, where you can sketch out these sort of very unrealistic things like a mouse hunting a lion, a car with triangular wheels, and you can just very directly guide that through the sketch. You can also do interesting things like start with an image, extract its segmentation, and then edit the segmentation. So here I can say, instead of the sky and trees, I want there to be sea, and instead of grass, I want it to be sand, and I leave everything else the same. And now you can essentially do image editing through the scene layout. Here I'm editing the image to now add a giant dog to it. And so that's what the generated image has. You can also use this for generating variations of images. So I can start with an image, extract its segmentation, and then hold the segmentation constant, but then change the text to generate different variations of the same image. And so this again was all pre-diffusions. This was all transformer-based models. And then soon we also started looking much more at diffusion models. And so here's one work called KNN Diffusion that leverages retrieval in the process of trying to generate images. So what it does is during training, it starts with an image. It finds its nearest neighbors, and then conditioned on those nearest neighbors, it tries to generate an image. And then at test time, instead of the image encoder, if the input is text, you encode that text and again find nearest neighbors conditioned on that text, and then condition on those neighbors to generate the image. And so what's nice about this is that because you are leveraging retrieval, including at inference time, your model can be much smaller. Your model doesn't have to know everything. It doesn't have to store all the knowledge. It can leverage a whole database of images that already exists. The other nice thing about this is that this model was trained entirely with unpaired data. So as I said, during training, you're only using images. You're not using text at all. But at test time, you can swap in a text encoder, for example, and a clip encoder for text and use that. And so during training, you haven't seen any paired data. And so what this allows you to do, this combination of the fact that you're leveraging retrieval and the fact that you don't need paired data, what that lets you do is it allows you to use this model for new styles and for new domains at test time, something that you hadn't trained for at all, by swapping in the database from which you're doing the retrieval. So let's say my model was trained on photorealistic images, but now I want to generate, let's say, paintings, or I want to generate these cartoonish stickers. At test time, at inference time, I can swap in a database of stickers. And now, and I don't need that to be paired data. I just need to find a set of unlabeled sticker images. And I can start generating stickers in a way that's guided from text. And so that's quite exciting. So here's an example of stickers that this model generates. It has never seen paired text and sticker data. And they're quite delightful. We also have adaptations of this approach that allows us to manipulate stickers. So we can start with a sticker of an avocado, and then you can say that I want the same sticker, the same avocado, but with red lipstick. And you can, the model can generate this. And again, this isn't with any paired data that it was trained on. Here are more examples of the original sticker on the left, and then a variety of different variations guided by the text that you're seeing at the bottom of it. And that paper, by the way, is online. So if you'd like to check that out, if you want to check out the details of it, you're welcome to do that. All right, so let's talk about video. That is what I was primarily invited to talk about. And so this is the Make a Video system. It's a text to video generation model that doesn't need any text video paired data. So that's a bit of a theme here. And the way that it works is on the left. So let me actually first describe the high level concept behind this. So the high level concept is that we want to be leveraging very heavily text to image generation approaches, text to image generation models to try and generate video. And so what the idea is that you can have the model learn what the world looks like and how we talk about it in text through image and text paired data. So through that paired data, it can learn what the world looks like and how we talk about it in language. And then we can learn how the world moves from a set of videos that doesn't need any paired data. They're just from a set of unsupervised, unlabeled videos. We can learn how stuff in the world tends to look like. So if something looks like waves, then this is how it likely moves. If something looks like a dog, this is how it likely moves. But what it means to be a dog, what it looks like to be a dog, is what we learn from image text data. And so the model is set up, as you see here, I'll describe the inference process, where during inference, you take in as input a piece of text, and we use a prior model to generate a 3D blob of 64 by 64, of 16 frames, where each frame is 64 by 64. And then we have super resolution models that increase the resolution of these frames all the way up to 768 by 768. And we have a frame interpolation model that increases the resolution in the temporal dimension. So it it's doing super resolution in the temporal dimension to increase the frames per second. The neat thing here is the way in which this model is trained, and particularly in the sense of how this model is initialized. So when we're generating this 3D blob, the spatial parameters are all initialized with a text-to-image generation model. And then the parameters that guide the temporal connections between these frames is the only thing that needs to be trained from scratch. And those parameters are the ones that are trained using a collection of videos. And so at initialization, this model, the first set of 64 by 64, 16 frames, will generate 16 frames that are all independent images. So they're just a text-to-image generation model that will give you these 16 frames. They will be spatially coherent. They'll be semantically relevant to the text, but there's not going to be any temporal coherence at all. There will be no temporal smoothness. So that's at initialization. And then over the course of the training, it's that piece that the model tries to learn, where it learns how to now generate these 16 frames in a way that are temporally meaningful, such that they look like actual videos as learned from a collection of unsupervised videos. So the key takeaways, one is that this allows us to do text-to-video generation in a more sort of accelerated way, because you're directly transferring all of the knowledge that text-to-image generation models had directly through the parameter initialization. As a consequence of this, these models inherit all of the vastness of sort of styles and diversity and content that these text-to-image generation models tend to have, which means that the set of videos that we train on, even if there are certain sort of fantastical things or certain concepts that are not depicted there, this model can still generate that content because it's leveraging everything that the text image generation model knew. And finally, as I said, that it doesn't need text to video data. And so it has the potential where you can now scale it up to train on more and more videos because you don't need paired text data. All right, so that was a lot of talking on a slide that was mostly static. I should have animated the approach a little bit more, but here's maybe more delightful visual content. Here's a generated video with Make a Video, a dog wearing a superhero outfit with red cape flying through the sky. There is a table by a window with sunlight streaming through, illuminating a pile of books. A blue unicorn flying over a mystical land. And so this is that example that I was giving you, that our video data set that we trained on didn't have blue unicorns or unicorns of any sort doing anything. But because we have these image generation models, it has picked up on what unicorns look like, and it can bring in some motion if it's seen horses and other animals to essentially kind of animate this unicorn in a meaningful way. And here are a few more examples. Some of these had become quite popular. This one, a teddy bear painting, a portrait, was a bit of a hit. This fluffy baby sloths, I might show you more of these later, that's confused by a laptop, was also a bit of a favorite. This robot dancing in Times Square is also kind of fun. All right, and so this model also lets you do other things somewhat for free, if you will, that instead of text to video, you can also do image to video. And so you can start with an image like the one that you see on the left and basically bring it to life, animate it, make predictions of what happened next from where this painting was made. You can also take two frames and interpolate a video in a meaningful way between those. You can also do variations of videos. So here the input video is on the left and on the right. These are four variations that we can generate off that, where the motion is meaningful, the semantic concepts are maintained, but it's not like an exact duplicate of what you're seeing here. The videos that I showed you were quite short. We can also generate longer videos. It's not with the same level of quality, but here's one where you might be curious what happens to this teddy bear if you just wait longer. And you can see that its ear at this point has kind of gotten attached to the billboard behind it. And we'll see that it decides to give up on the ear and kind of go on this journey in Times Square. That doesn't get a whole lot exciting, but is a little bit more exciting than the bear just stuck there. All right, and so one last piece that I want to talk about is this work that we've done on audio generation. So text to audio generation. So this is not text to speech. This is not generating only music. It's sort of generic sounds, any sounds. And when I play this video, what you'll see at the top is the input. So this was the text prompt, whistling with wind blowing. And what you should hear are sounds that that should match the input text. And you can see that it kind of sounds like generic speech, but it's not actually words. All right, I think you got the idea on that one. So the last thing I want to mention is this data set that we've publicly released that I think might be helpful for folks who are interested in getting involved in sort of these multimodal generative models, but maybe don't have the compute or don't have sort of these large data sets to train on, but you can still kind of get your hands dirty and sort of test some ideas out. So what this data set is it's a closed world. It's a narrowly defined world like the one that you see here. There's a few different visuals to this. There's about a dozen characters or so. Some are friendly, some are some sort of, it's like a video game. So some characters kill each other and so on. We have this pixel accurate semantic segmentation of every single frame because it's a closed world. We have audio associated with various events. You'll see that in a second. We have textual descriptions of what's happening in these scenes, both as described by humans, so in natural language, and also templated text. And so here's what this looks like. And so it's 375,000 video clips, like the one you saw. It has audio, it has video, it has text, it has segmentation maps, and you can study all kinds of retrieval and generation problems like text to audio, audio to video, video to audio, and all of those things. So you're welcome to check that out. All right, I seem to have misplaced my phone, so I don't have a sense of time. If anyone is on the call, can you let me know how much more time I have?
You've got 10 minutes, so you're doing well.
Okay, sounds good. So maybe I'll take another 5 or so minutes to show some extra content, and then I want to leave some time in the end for questions as well. So this will be more sort of just a generic set of things that I'm excited about that I just want to show you. So one is we have this Fair Artist in Residence program where we had three artists who had participated, Scott Eaton, Sophia Crespo, Stephanie Dinkins. For any of you who follow the AI and art intersection. You've probably come across their work in various contexts. And so one neat thing that came out of this was Sofia Crespo's project was shown at Times Square in New York. They have these, I forget exactly what it's called, but it's like this 3-minute window at midnight where they showcase art projects on these, on the giant screens. And so this is what it looked like. So all of these screens in Times Square had generative art on them showing Sofia Crespo's project. And so that was pretty amazing to see. Here's a few more photos of that. And just to give you a sense for the vibe a little bit. Yeah, so that was cool. This is a video that we had generated very early on with diffusion models because of the way diffusion models are set up, where you can sort of have this continuous process where you're deforming one image into another. And so I'll just play this on the, these are old models, so the image quality isn't great, but it's still kind of a delightful experience.
Raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens, bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens, brown paper packages tied up with strings. These are a few of my favorite things. Cream-colored ponies and crisp apple strudels, doorbells and sleigh bells and schnitzel with noodles, wild geese that fly with the moon on their wings. These are a few.
I think you get the idea. And there's been a whole bunch more of these delightful things that folks have shared on social media. So it's definitely not the only one. Here's some visuals of what we had shared when we released Make a Scene, different generations from the same sketch. This is one of my favorites. This was a designer on our team who had sketched out these cats in different shapes. So that's it, right? That's the only sketch prompt. And the text says a colorful sculpture of a cat. And the fact that you can have these 3D looking generations in these different poses because you can guide it through sketch, right? Without that, it would be hard to get exactly what you're looking for. This is to illustrate that the sketch is optional. You don't need it. Even without the sketch, you can just have text to image generation, and it's fairly high quality images. These are the artists who we had given access to Make a Scene, who shared their art and their experiences. Their interviews are on the blog post. If you're curious to hear what they had to say about this added control, you should check that out. Here's some snapshots of the art that various people had created. This one is a story that Oran, who was the first author on Make a Scene, he wrote the story, he illustrated it using Make a Scene, and he narrated it to generate this kind of visual storybook. So we won't have time to listen to the whole thing, but I'll play it so it gives you a sense.
This is the first children's story I've written. While I wrote all the text, I used our own drawing demo to generate all the illustrations. Let's read a story. It's a short story called The Little Red Boat. The little red boat woke up near the shore one day. Where are all his friends? He couldn't say. He decided to set sail to the open sea to find out where everyone could be. Where should I go first? The little red boat pondered. As he scouted.
I'll pause this here, but you get a sense. The boat then goes around. There's a storm. It gets stuck. There's a whole bunch of fish that come help it and free it. And then eventually it lives happily ever after. There's another one that has more people and a story of a family that's going to be moving to India.
This is the second story I've written.
And the daughter is sort of uncertain about what that would mean. And there's a dinosaur friend that shows up. And yeah, so that's all illustrated as well. These are more generations from Make a Video. Two kangaroos are busy cooking dinner in a kitchen. This had become our go-to example while we were working on the project. I promised you more baby slots. So here, here you see those, all nine of them confused. And yeah, I think I'll just summarize here. So creativity is what excites me about this. It's at the core of all progress society makes. And creative expression in particular is a deeply human experience. And so I feel like if we can have technology in general, AI tools in particular, for augmenting human creativity, that would be quite exciting. There's a whole bunch of AI challenges here, different classes of generative models, like diffusion models, which we're talking about today, how to evaluate these models, how to give people more control over what these models are doing, making sort of human-AI collaboration more central to the research that we do. I haven't seen enough of that in the community so far. Thinking of applicability, that where is it that we're trying to use these models, and incorporating those things into the design of these models. All of this together can be a fairly powerful use of technology. And I think there's tremendous scope for exciting work here. So with that, I will stop and I'm happy to take questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Divi. That was a really illuminating talk, especially for someone like myself who only really does NLP. And seeing the power of, you know, text and video and audio is pretty impressive. We got a few questions from the audience. So the first one, I think, is sort of generally about the sort of make a video demo you showed, where they ask, the images that are generated are kind of abstract and cartoonish, and that means they don't seem to be quite, you know, accurate. Are there any examples from your own work or from other things at Meta of generating kind of like photorealistic videos? And if not, sort of how far do you think that is into the future, given the pace, you know, the rate of progress so far is pretty astronomical?
Yeah. So our intent wasn't to only generate sort of cartoonish looking images. I'll have to go back and check whether my examples have a bias in that direction. But it might be that the ones that to me seem photorealistic, the person who's asking the question is just saying like, yeah, but that's not high enough quality. So there is a website for Make a Video that has more examples than what I showed. So you should definitely check that out. There is a chance that you'll see that and still feel like, yeah, the photorealistic stuff isn't quite up there yet. And there's definitely more work to be done. The resolution, like I said, what we shared out was 512 by 512. So getting the resolution higher for sure. The actual photorealism is one thing, but then even the temporal aspects is not always perfect. These objects don't always move in the right way. There are some artifacts that you will see as the objects are moving, as the objects interact with other scenes. So there's definitely a ton of room for improvement, even in this shorter clips that we're generating. And then when you think about longer videos and having scene transitions and having consistency, that maybe you talk about a teddy bear for a while and then you talked about something else, then you come back to the teddy bear, you want the same teddy bear to show up, right? All of that is entirely missing, not just from Make a Video, but even in general in works that are out there for video generation. So yeah, there's a ton to be done here to get to more expressive, longer, higher quality videos.
Awesome. So I have a slightly controversial question, which is, I think, a very common one actually in the community, which is essentially like, you know, we've got these generative models and they're kind of trained on artist styles or, you know, other images and videos and audio and so on. And I was kind of curious, like, you know, what's your thoughts about, like, you know, how we kind of go forward as a community? And, you know, what do you think are like the kind of exciting directions maybe of like how we can bridge the gap of respecting, you know, artists who've worked hard to generate the, you know, the training data basically that we're using?
Yeah, this is, it's a very rich question. there's a lot to say here. And I don't know if I necessarily have the answers, but I can at least share a few points of view that I've come across that I think makes sense. So one is, there has been some thought given to, is there a way to have more systematic ways of attributing like work back to whoever contributed to the training data, and even mapping that to some form of compensation? And so I know there is some work on saying that if these were all the images here, and so whichever model uses this data set, if you know who all contributed to this, which can happen in the case of sort of curated data sets, then there's a certain attribution that goes back to them, and maybe even compensation if whatever image is being generated is being used for monetary purposes. So that's one. The one that I had seen was kind of a uniform attribution and compensation back. If there are ways to figure out which of the training images influence this final image more so than others, then maybe there can be a little bit more of an meaningful and sort of uneven way of attributing it. So that's one. The second is, there are some people who've been saying that, like, should we just create these data sets from scratch in a more sort of cleaner way, maybe even have a whole lot of synthetic data so there is less concern around using sort of existing IP. So that's, I think, another potential path that could also help here. I also hear opinions on sort of the counter that, for example, says that when you like when you search on Google, you get these images back. Whatever it is that you do, like whatever ideas you got from there, and then you do something else with it, there isn't this mechanism of attributing it back. And so should we start thinking of generative models more as sort of search engines? And I know that's something that Stability AI, for example, has been using that kind of an articulation, not in terms of attribution, I mean, just the piece of thinking of generative models as kind of replacing search engines kind of thing. So there's that point of view, thinking about that humans get influenced by others' work all the time, like even in artists, that artists get inspired by each other, and that affects their work. And if that's okay, then why is this different? And the argument usually is that this is at a whole different scale than just me going to a gallery and looking at somebody's piece of work. And so we can't necessarily use the argument of like, well, if that was fine, why is this an issue? So I know, as I said, I'm not giving any definitive answers. I'm just kind of sharing some thoughts that have registered in my mind. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll say one thing that's interesting is like in the big code project that Hugging Face is part of about training code generation models, this is a similar issue, right? Of like, you know, code and author of code on GitHub. And the approach they've taken there is been to essentially have a search so you can remove yourself from the training set. And there's like a kind of window of opportunity where you can say, okay, I exclude myself. And, you know, maybe these will be the future models for like, you know, if we, especially if we train things in the open, then at least you can say, okay, it's like, you know, you're building a house, you have a month to complain about the windows and then.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think that makes sense. The issue there could be one for artists who aren't around anymore, like who on their behalf could withdraw themselves from the data set. And the second is how much awareness there is that how broadly is this being disseminated, and is everyone aware that they have this opportunity and so on. But yeah, I think that makes sense.
Awesome. So thank you so much for joining us tonight, Debbie. It was a wonderful talk, and we'll see you at the next event.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Take care.
Thanks Bye-bye. A lot.
Okay, so right. Next speaker is Justin. Do you want to introduce him, Jono?
Yeah, sure. So Justin, I'm very excited to have you here. Justin is a senior machine learning researcher at Lambda Labs, working on image generation and editing, particularly for artistic and creative applications. And his specialty and the thing that I think I know him for and many of you might know him for is taking these pre-trained models and adapting them to add new capabilities or to come up with like new use cases. So if you've seen, for example, Text to Pokemon, which was a fine tune of Stable Diffusion, or the image variations version where you could feed in an image rather than a text prompt, those are some of his more well-known projects, but he's done lots of other work as well. So Justin, really great to have you here.
Cool. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm really excited to be up in this lineup. So the talk, I guess I'm going to give, and the title was talking about like beyond text. So sort of other types of kind of input and conditioning other than text. And I think we've heard actually a lot about that in some of the previous work. So hopefully it follows on quite nicely. And I guess, yeah, just a bit more background about myself. I mean, I've been involved in the sort of like generative AI and art and editing side of things for a few years. And it was initially my hobby where I just do these things in my spare time. But now it's like my full-time job at Lambda, which you might know them better for sort of selling GPU workstations and servers and having a GPU cloud. But we also have a small research group, both for like public stuff and also privately for some of our customers as well. So I was thinking about the topic of my talk, which is going to be sort of presenting a few of these like experiments and these things that I kind of built on top of Stable Diffusion to kind of give extra levels of control sort of beyond the normal text input, which I guess we're all familiar with. But I realized actually the sort of higher level message of my talk is actually maybe suggests a different title, which is like the endless hackability of Stable Diffusion. And I think it's a really important point that the release of Stable Diffusion as an open model, which is of reasonable size, all the training code and data available, has really like opened the doors to like experimentation and playing with the model beyond just doing inference with it. And I really feel like the release of Stable Diffusion was kind of like a StyleGAN moment for diffusion models and text to image generally. And if you're not familiar with StyleGAN, it was this really great began a few years ago, which was state of the art in terms of generating, like, most famously, high resolution images of people's faces who didn't exist. And all the code was released openly, and the model checkpoints were available, and tons of people went away and trained it on their own domains or kind of made modifications and added new things to it. And it was really like opened the floodgates to innovation. I think a really similar thing is happening with Stable Diffusion just because of the way it's been released and the way it's accessible. So I guess going back to the sort of topic of my talk, probably most people who've used a text image model might understand why text isn't always enough. You know, often it's great that there's this kind of gap between text and images, which means you can be very concise about what you describe, and text is kind of ambiguous and sort of limited in many ways. And that's great because it's sort of easy for us to produce. And often the most exciting things are when the model interprets your text in a way you didn't necessarily intend or understand. That tends to produce lots of these kind of meme-worthy things that David Haar likes to present about. But sometimes it's just plain frustrating. So like, imagine trying to make a nice photograph of a cute kitten and you don't like the way that the ears look. So you kind of try and prompt it to have slightly less pointed ears, and that sort of works. But then you're trying to want to make the ears go a little bit further out to the side. That doesn't really work. And you can stuff a load of stuff into the prompt, and you still can't make the ears point outwards a little bit. And it would just be, there probably is a prompt that does it, but it's just much harder than, you know, maybe just drawing a sketch or kind of dragging the image around or kind of moving things around as a different modality to text. The other thing I think that highlights the limitations of text quite well is this phenomenon of using artist names in prompts, which has, you know, proved to be somewhat controversial. And I think, you know, quite often people aren't necessarily trying to rip off a particular artist when they're using a certain name in a prompt. And sometimes that's probably the case, but not always. And I think it's more an indication of sort of the limitations of our vocabulary when it comes to expressing concisely a sort of particular visual style. You know, our language doesn't really have the vocabulary to do it. And this is why we use artist names as a proxy for that, because often they have a very clear visual style and we use one to address the other. So I guess I'm going to present a few sort of experiments and kind of modifications I made to Stable Diffusion to maybe explore some of these different ways of conditioning the model beyond text, and hopefully present some of these, which are mostly kind of fun little hacks and playthings, but also point to some of the research in the area that kind of points to the direction, I think, that maybe some of the field is moving in. So the first one is maybe the one that you might have heard of before, which is this image variations version of Stable Diffusion. I'm going to talk about what that is and how it works in a second. But just to recap on Stable Diffusion, probably everyone is familiar with this concept that, you know, in Stable Diffusion, you have this sort of image generation part. So there's a new net, which is this denoising diffusion model, which takes kind of these noisy latents and denoises them to, you know, some image, which you have to pass through the decoder to get the actual image out. And the kind of important point here is that this process is conditional on some text. And the way that text is kind of introduced into the process is that you have this clip text encoder, which takes this prompt and produces these tokens, which are kind of a numerical representation of the text itself. And that gets fed in as kind of side information to the unit while it's denoising, and it can generate something which matches the prompt. Now, something that's kind of clear is that, you know, this part isn't particularly, doesn't need to be text specific. You can essentially rip this out and replace it with anything which generates, you know, something at least which is kind of compatible, you know, some sort of vectors which you're going to put into the unit to the side to change what it understands of what you're asking it to do. So one thing that I did kind of really early on, soon after Stable Diffusion was released, actually with the 1.3 checkpoint, I think, was to sort of rip out that text encoder part and replace it instead with the clip image encoder. So I didn't invent this. This was actually from the DALL-E 2 paper. This is how, you know, the DALL-E 2 image generator works. It's based on clip image encodings. So here you kind of give an input image and you pass it through the clip image encoder. It produces this this vector, which is 768 numbers, which somehow summarizes this image. And it tends to have things like the sort of content and the objects and maybe the style of the image kind of captured within it, but clearly it's not enough information to really completely define what's in that image. So that gets fed into the unit, and then you know, it learns to generate images based on those clip image embeddings. So what happens when you kind of generate an image with, you know, this different sort of prompt, which is kind of like an image prompt, or you get out the other end an image which has a lot of similarity with the original. You know, it has a lot of the same content. There's kind of fruit and bowls, and it's on a table, and the stylistically it's kind of similar as well, but it's not the same image clearly. So this is a kind of method for making image variations. And here's a couple more examples. This, a few more with this painting by Matisse, and then a frame from a Studio Ghibli movie. You can see if we pass those as our prompt, we get these kind of variations on a theme of the image. And it's really nice that you get, you know, similar content, similar styles, but, you know, clearly different compositions, different arrangements and different details. And, you know, it's just fun to see these things, and fun to kind of get maybe inspiration for how an image can be reimagined. But we can also do some other interesting things. So one thing which has always fascinated me with these sorts of models is that when we encode an image, so here's an example on the top left of some like black and white photo of a meeting of kind of military people. When we encode this with a clip image encoder, we kind of put that into a place called latent space. So this like numerical vector is in this latent space where directions in here are kind of meaningful, and, you know, things that are closer are more similar and things that are far away are more different. So if we just encode the image and then generate a new one based on that encoding, we get, you know, one of those variations that we just saw. But one thing that might be really interesting to do is if we can move around in this latent space, so kind of, you know, move that vector in a certain directions, we can generate images which maybe are related to the original one, but somehow different. But the question is, like, how can we tell how to move in this latent space? Well, one advantage we can take from clip is that this latent space is actually shared between text and images. So we can pass in a couple of prompts to our to the text encoder part of clip, which also can project these text phrases into latent space, and we can put in a black and white photo and color oil painting. And then that's great. We can draw a line between those two points, and that gives us, you know, a direction maybe which points from black and white to color oil paintings. Then we can just take that arrow, add it onto our original position to get a new position in this latent space, and then generate an image from there. And, you know, we get something which seems to be an oil painting, but has a lot of the kind of content of the original image. So we can do this kind of editing in latent space and move around it to kind of manipulate our images, our generated images, in a meaningful way. So we can have another look at a different example, old black and white photo to modern DSLR photo. And you get, you know, a change in style. It kind of looks more modern. There's kind of this like depth of field effect, which suggests the DSLR. And this also works for things like content as well as just style. So it's really cool. And I think moving around in this latent space is really powerful and interesting. Like I say, I didn't invent that either. That was originally from the DALL-E 2 paper. So they again showed some examples where they can, you know, take images and have two prompts which are kind of different and move in the direction of that difference between the prompts. And here they actually do it better than me because they have this nice inversion method where they can take a real image and kind of find the noise that will recreate that image from the image encoder, and then they can actually edit the real image. So I think that's, you know, that's really cool. And I think a lot of what's interesting research that I've kind of seen along these lines recently as well has been, you know, taking that idea of having different sorts of encodings and kind of taking it further. So one recent paper called Versatile Diffusion actually takes text and image encodings. It also has some other bells and whistles to it, but it basically means it has this really adaptable model which can do all sorts of generations from images to text to images to images and images to text to images and all ways around. Another, I think, really interesting paper recently was this one, eDiffy by NVIDIA, where they take not only the clip text encoder, they also have another text encoder called T5, and they also use the clip image encoder. And they find that all of these things kind of impart different information onto the model while it's generating images. And so then at inference time, you can swap these things out and change them and actually influence, you know, how your image images generated in interesting ways. So one really nice example they have is this sort of style transfer type of example. They can generate an image based on a text prompt with a reference image. And then this middle row is their generated images of the prompt, but in a particular style from the reference image, which I think is a really nice application. So I really imagine like adding more kind of encoding and information to the conditioning of the model might be a really interesting route in kind of exerting new sort of dials of control into these models. So one of the sort of small extension that I was playing with recently was this kind of idea of not just image variations particularly, but face variations, sort of inspired by the popularity of these dream booth approaches, which have come about recently, where you know people take some images of their face and then fine tune a stable diffusion model on their face with a particular token and then try and put their face in new places. And right now it's great, but it's also really terrible. You know, it requires fine tuning the whole model and then you have to store a whole model per person. So it seems completely impractical. And so I was wondering, you know, is there a route to making these things where it's, you know, you don't need to train a whole new model each time. So one thing that I tried kind of recently is kind of taking the existing approach of having these sort of clip image encodings, but actually taking two different encodings. So one kind of specifically focused on the face region, and then one kind of mask out that face, just put a like gray square over the top of it, and then give clip the rest of the image as well. So maybe, and then you generate these two tokens or these two embeddings from that process. So one which hopefully corresponds more to the face, the identity, probably also the expression as well. And then the other one from the surrounding, which kind of corresponds to you know, the hair, the hat, the lighting, or any beard or anything else like that. And so you can train this model on a bunch of face data, and maybe it'll get really good at generating faces with these sort of two points of control. So I fine-tuned a model, a stable diffusion model on this, and here are a couple of example faces from this Celeb A dataset. So if we just take those two images and encode them into those two embeddings, and then just give them as the condition to the clip, the image generation model, hopefully we'll see rows of, you know, this same person in pretty much the same situation. And yeah, it kind of works. They're probably slightly different people according to our like keen sense of a facial recognition, but you know, it's pretty close and pretty similar. So that's kind of neat. You can sort of generate slight variations on pictures of yourself maybe. But what's actually more interesting is, what if you take, you know, we had these two different embeddings, what if we take one of them from a different picture? So here we can take the embedding from the sort of facial region from these two on the left, and then the sort of the embedding from the kind of external region from these images at the top. And if we mix them together and generate, then we kind of get this person is sort of generated, you know, hopefully something that's quite close to their face, but with the context of the surrounding area. So it's given, you know, long hair, or it's introduced the hat or the messy hair of Peter Jackson. And this works, you know, quite well. I wouldn't say it's like the quality of Dream Booth at the moment, but it's, you know, it's a very interesting approach, and was like, you know, really easy thing to do, and, you know, essentially adapting that image variation code and fine tuning for, you know, maybe a day or so. And I feel like there's plenty of scope here to keep on exploring these ideas, you know, either introducing like facial recognition modules, which are more designed to recognize entity features or things like that. And I really think the future of Dream Booth is not fine tuning all these models, but it's actually just a model which takes an image of your face and can then just put you in new situations. And yeah, I was kind of also recently saw this paper about exerting more sort of spatial control. So here's a sort of similar idea that they have a prompt, but then also regions of the image which can have different prompts, so that you can kind of be much more controlled about the structure and composition of your image. So here the approach is a bit more sophisticated, but the sort of basic concept is similar. So that was like a kind of one type of control that you can sort of exert over these things, and they're not exclusive to you know, they don't replace, they don't have to replace the text, even though I did it in this case. You know, often you can combine those things. And I think definitely, if you think about all of the types of sort of these embeddings you can generate from images, whether it's like facial features or kind of landmarks or pose estimations or you know, anything else you can think of, you could use that as a conditioning for the image generation module, and you can kind of generate new features, new images which have those sorts of properties. So I think, you know, this space is like really ripe for exploration and play. So the second half, I was going to talk a bit more briefly, but about a different type of conditioning that you can have. So all of those ones that I just showed were, you know, condensing down an image into, you know, a small vector or a couple of small vectors, which you use as the condition for generation. But there's another approach you can take, which is kind of well explained and demonstrated by this idea of super resolution. So in super resolution, you want to take a low resolution, low quality image, and you want to generate a high resolution, high quality image that could have made that low resolution one. And so if we look at our previous diagram of stable diffusion, you know, you saw that information, the encoded information from the text prompt came in sort of to the side. But there's a different route you can take when you're doing things like super resolution, is that you can take the whole image as a condition. And here you have to sort of move it into this latent space in which stable diffusion operates. And then instead of sort of putting it at the side, you just kind of slap it onto the end of your noisy latents and pass them to the unit altogether. So it's sort of implicitly saying that there's some kind of pointwise correspondence between the sort of condition image that I'm giving you and the image that I want to generate. And then you can, you know, generate your train it to generate a high resolution version of that image. This is a pretty easy thing to set up for training, because you can pretty easily generate a low quality image from a high resolution thing. You just downsample it and add some degradations. So you can pretty easily create the sort of paired data set to essentially go in reverse. And the really nice thing is that all the code for this is already in the Stable Diffusion training repos. Because, you know, all of this has been done, and you know, in the latent diffusion paper, there's some really nice super resolution examples. So I'm not going to talk about this too much, but before there was this official Stable Diffusion V2 super resolution module, I trained one of these just fine-tuning the original Stable Diffusion, and you know, you get in a put in a low resolution image of a cat, and you get out a high resolution image of a cat, so it adds back all of that like fur detail and texture on the chair or whatever it is. And depending on how well that shows up on screen share, this is like a zoomed in version. And you can see it works pretty well. For those who are used to looking at like AI generated images, if you look at the whiskers, you can see that they're not very coherent, which is like one of the telltale ways of spotting a generated image, but it's pretty good. And now there are like these really high quality kind of official checkpoints, which I think actually kind of comparable to this one I'm showing, but it does also have the nice extra feature that you can text guide that one, which is pretty cool. And you know, this is kind of a generic technique for all sorts of degradations that you can apply to images. So there was this nice paper called Palette from a little while ago, which seems like a long time ago at the pace of things. But you know, if you apply degradations like, say, making your image grayscale, you can train the network to essentially undo that. I think applications like that are really interesting and stuff I haven't actually seen a great deal. You know, think about text-guided image colorization would be like a really interesting, you know, fine-tune or adaptation of Stable Diffusion, which I certainly haven't seen yet. And the other example is from, you know, that kind of seminal latent diffusion paper, which, you know, as well as showing this kind of super resolution approach on the right, they also showed this other nice nice kind of version of this, where you can give it a kind of semantic layout, you know, a map of where things should appear in the image, and you can generate a new image based on that. And you know, that gives you this extra level of control, which is really, really appealing. So the last thing I was going to show is something which is kind of related to the video side of things, but slightly maybe less practical and more on the kind of interesting and aesthetically pleasing side. So there's this, I was trying to think of what other kinds of whole image conditioning can you apply? You know, clearly you can take an image and degrade it somehow and learn to undo that. But there's this this kind of well-established technique of next frame prediction, which takes a video and sort of treats it as just a sequence of frames. And so you can train a network to take in one frame and predict what do you think the next frame is going to be given this starting point. And once you've trained something that does that, you can really easily generate a video. You give it a real image, generate the next frame, and then say, okay, take that frame that you just made, predict the next frame, and just keep doing that until you've made this like long, long video. And there are some really awesome examples of that in, you know, that have been around for quite a long time. One that I saw a long time ago and found really inspiring is this work from Damien Henry, where he trained one of these networks on videos from a train window. And you can see these like beautiful sort of abstract images, which kind of give the impression of traveling and don't really have a photorealistic quality, but extremely interesting and appealing. And a bunch of other artists who I think are really, really talented have shown work like this before. So Mario Klingerman and Derek Schultz have like these really nice examples of these kind of next frame prediction videos on different data sets. So I thought, okay, well, that's pretty easy to do. I'll just take my super resolution thing, just replace the high resolution and low resolution with one frame and the next frame, and then train fine-tune Stable Diffusion to do that task. And then I can come up with this next frame prediction version. So I was on a train to a conference last week. I just spent most of my time capturing short video clips out of the window at various points to collect a data set. And then by the time I got home, I could adapt my code, load up the data and split it into frames from the videos and then let it train overnight. And then when I got back to it, I could give it one example real frame and then just generate next frames from all of those recursively and make, apart from the first frame, generate all the rest of the frames sort of artificially. And I threw that first frame away anyway. So this whole video is just generated from this fine-tuned Stable Diffusion on train windows. And I don't know how well it'll come across on the screen share on the video, but it's kind of amazing. And you can see it on my Twitter profile or my YouTube, maybe a higher quality, but it's kind of amazing that it's almost lost some of the aesthetic appeal from those previous videos because it's almost too good. I'll try and play it again. We kind of crossed the uncanny valley and we sort of come out the other side and it's become a slightly boring train video again, which is kind of fun, but maybe defeats the object. But the fun thing is, because you have access to this model and you can manipulate in all sorts of ways, you can actually make videos which are kind of more interesting than that by manipulating things, manipulating what are the inputs to the models. You can make these kind of really mesmerizing videos where you're kind of traveling through these completely fictitious landscapes. And yeah, for me, this is like super appealing and super interesting. All of this is completely generated from one frame, just predict the next frame, and it keeps on coming up with all these like crazy, strange and fascinating things, which I could watch for hours. So I guess the other thing to say about this is that's a really hacky way of making a video with these diffusion models. Like we heard in the previous talk and some of these other papers, so there's this video diffusion models paper as well. There are much more sophisticated, better ways of making kind of coherent, nice videos over time. So often they have things like temporal convolutions or temporal attention. But that next frame prediction aspect is a really easy way of doing it, kind of repurposing that existing model without too much change, so you can generate something in just maybe overnight's worth of training. And then finally, another sort of similar application, which I thought is really cool, is this like novel view synthesis that came out with the diffusion models, where you sort of give an input view and you train a network, train this diffusion model to predict different angles of those views, which I think is really quite amazing that you might be able to look around an object without having any access to anything beyond a photo of the object. So I guess in sort of conclusion, hopefully that's kind of an overview of some of the other ways that you can kind of modify these networks, other levers of control that you can try and exert on Stable Diffusion. And also hopefully it gives you an idea that, you know, these things are like really easy to mess around with and kind of hack together and fine tune. So like if you spend some time learning about how these things work, these are like extremely accessible and easy. And I'd like encourage anybody who sort of wants to go a bit beyond the just inference or just dream boothing to like play around with some of these things and train new models and new capabilities. So just to kind of recap, there are these like image variations models, which I used a new checkpoint for those examples, which I'll try and upload to the Hugging Face Hub probably tomorrow at this point. There's this face variations things, which I think has potential, but I kind of want to spend some more time working on it, try and get some higher quality results. The super resolution thing, which I'll probably release that checkpoint at some point, but there is this kind of official Stable Diffusion V2 version. And then this next frame prediction thing, which I think is really cool, but probably not very useful. But I'll try and kind of tidy up a notebook so that it's easy for people to do these things on their own videos and own data sets. And with that, thank you very much. And you can like find me on the Lambda blog or on Twitter on my own blog, which I occasionally update. Very interested to see what other experiments that people might do from here would be. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Justin, for a really awesome talk. I think you kind of really encapsulate the hacker, you know, culture that has been built around, you know, Stable Diffusion and diffusion models of like, you know, maybe we don't have access to a TPU farm, but we can still make, you know, pretty cool videos. So I think we have time for one question from the audience. So I think this one is kind of interesting about the comment you made about not necessarily having to always train new models like, you know, Dream Booth and that, you know, when we want to, you know, adapt a model to our face and so on. And so the question is, you know, do you think there will be like thousands of kind of diffusion models in the future that are created by individuals like yourself? Or do you think that we'll start to see kind of like a, you know, conglomeration where it's like, okay, this is like the best video or the best model for like, you know, putting your face in a video or whatever, a picture, mm-hmm. so on. Just curious what you think.
Yeah, I think that's kind of interesting. I think like the trend tends to be, you know, at some point someone with a lot of resources releases, you know, a big model, and then there's always scope to make that big, perhaps general model better on your particular thing that you care about by fine tuning it. So, you know, everyone uses that as a base or maybe a few bases and make specific models, which are really good. But I feel like the sort of the rule that we kind of learned based on sort of the way deep learning scales is that eventually, you know, someone with even more resources and even more data will train an even bigger or better model, which will then sort of surpass all of those things. But then, you know, you still have that opportunity to make that a little bit better as long as you have the resources to train it or fine tune it for your own specific kind of use case. So I think it'll always be the sort of case that there are these kind of like progression of sort of, you know, big, you know, I've heard people use these like terms of foundation models, but you know, these big pre-trained models, and then there'll be a whole bunch of sort of variations or specializations that people make for their own particular niche or own particular applications kind of on top of those.
Awesome. So I think we should move on, and thanks again for a really nice talk, and thanks for the time you took to talk to the Hugging Face community. And you know, there's a few hundred people watching this online right now, so yeah. Lots cool. of comments of people you know, really excited. So catch you later.
Great. Thank you, Justin. So our next speaker is quite exciting because we have Robin Rombach, who is coming to talk to us about Stable Diffusion and Friends. So Robin is a research scientist at Stability AI. And although he has a background in physics, I think he got his PhD in computer science at the Computer Vision Group in Heidelberg, which is where a lot of the work on things like VQGAN, taming transformers, latent diffusion models, which then became Stable Diffusion, a lot of that work went down. So very excited to have one of the OG authors here with us. Robin, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for the intro. I don't have the PhD yet, so I'm still affiliated with the Corpus group, but okay, so I want to talk about a bit, of course, about Stable Diffusion, but more about like the underlying methods we developed in the research group. And also, as you already mentioned, VQGAN is closely related, so I'll also bring that up. And in general, I'm talking about this family of two-stage generative models, which Stable Diffusion is one instance of. So in general, Stable Diffusion is a text-to-image neural network. So this means that this model can be used to generate and also to modify images based on text inputs. And for me, it has been like really surreal to see this what people call Cambrian explosion of creative AI, with thousands of, I mean, different fine-tuned dream booth versions of the model, of repositories that tinker with the model and so on. It's it has been really cool, really surreal. And maybe one highlight that I just saw a few days back was this object tape to the wall diffusion model, which I think is kind of peak creativity. But yeah, let's look back on how we actually got there. And yeah, as I said, Stable Diffusion is a two-stage generative model, and I think one view to view this two-stage generative models is that they actually can combine domain knowledge and a general purpose generative modeling paradigm. So what this means is this, that the modeling is separated into two different stages, which are usually not trained jointly together, but you first train the first stage and then the second stage. So what this gives you is that you can actually, in the first stage, design something that is domain specific or data specific. So it can take in images or maybe video, 3D structures, whatever you're interested in, and map this to a so-called latent representation on which you then train a general generative model in the second stage, which can be a diffusion model, but also a transformer or other things. And this means that you can kind of separate the generative process from the process that requires domain knowledge. And maybe it's a nice way to actually collaborate with different backgrounds and so on. So one instance of this is this Leon model, which is a latent diffusion model for 3D shape generation. I think this was published yesterday or 2 days ago. It's latent space diffusion models of cryo-EM structures. For structural biology modeling. And actually, another instance of that is DALL-E 2. And this is like what Stable Diffusion is also about, is using domain knowledge of the image domain to compress images into a lower dimensional space in which it is very easy to actually do generative modeling. So DALL-E 2 uses CLIP, which is a contrastively trained model to compress input images into this low-dimensional vector space. And then they train a diffusion prior on this vector space to kind of invert this process. So why is it actually important to incorporate this domain knowledge when you want to model images? And let me maybe try to explain this with this example here, this image of the squirrel. But when we are interested in doing generative modeling of such images, it is important to capture the global structure of the image. But we're usually not that interested in modeling all the exact high frequency local structures, so the texture here. So for example, in the case of the fur of the squirrel, the main thing that we're interested in is that it looks like realistic fur, but we are not really interested in the precise locations or interactions of these individual hairs. And using this insight can actually really help to train better generative models, because if we can get rid of these imperceptible high frequency details in the first stage, then the generative model does not necessarily need to learn the distribution over them. And because these are kind of imperceptible details, it does not have to waste capacity on something that we do not see in the end anyways. This is kind of the general motivation behind that. And like our first work on that was VQGAN in the paper Taming Transformers for High Resolution Image Synthesis that we published 2 years ago. And I would like to briefly talk about this, because the underlying motivation architecture is actually very similar to Stable Diffusion. So to avoid modeling these fine high frequency details that would kind of lead to wasting model capacity, we introduced this VQGAN model, and VQGAN builds on another previous work, which represents an image as a sequence of entries from a learned codebook. More precisely, we used the VQVAE architecture, which was introduced as a model for neural discrete representation learning. And in a nutshell, this approach relies on the straight-through gradient estimator and vector quantization to simultaneously learn this codebook and the encoder and decoder modules, which are convolutional neural networks. And after training this first stage model, this VQVAE, this will produce a compact discrete representation of an image from which you, like, you can take the image, encode it into that discrete representation, and decode back into image space from it. But VQVAE, as it was introduced, relied only on pixel-wise losses such as L2 or L1 losses. And using only that is not kind of using enough domain knowledge about images, because if we do that and reduce the capacity of the codebook too much, then we will have this typical blurry reconstructions. And if you want to do high-res image synthesis, we of course want to get we don't want to be bottlenecked by having blurry reconstructions. And to kind of overcome this issue, we actually need to avoid an objective which favors perfect pixel-wise reconstruction and would lead to averaging and blurring. And even more crucially, if you want to put the limits of compression and learning a nice discrete representation, we want to learn something that only captures the more global structure and gets rid of this high frequency details that I already talked about. And to ensure that, we introduced like two additional losses to the original VQVAE architecture. One is the LPIPS loss, which is a perceptual loss. So LPIPS is a perceptual loss which has been demonstrated to align well with human perception. And then the other thing that we introduced is a adversarial training on top of that. So we introduced another discriminator, which actually is trained in a patchwise fashion. So it's these local patches of the reconstructions of this VQGAN. And this ensures that we actually enforce local realism and don't have blurry reconstructions. And this means then that the total loss of this model is actually a combination of the VQ loss that is used to train the codebook, the reconstruction loss, and the adversarial loss. And because initially we found it extremely difficult to actually correctly weigh these terms, so we introduced a more dynamic strategy to weigh in the adversarial loss by calculating an adaptive weight that we then apply to this adversarial term. And this adaptive weight is simply the gradient of the reconstruction loss with respect to the last layer of the decoder divided by the gradient of the adversarial loss with respect to the last layer of the decoder. And this means that the contribution of the adversarial loss is decreased as soon as the gradient of the GAN loss is larger than the one of the reconstruction loss. And another important part of it is that we actually warm up the training first by training only with reconstruction and VQ loss, and then as soon as the model has already converged to something that looks like good reconstruction, but is not necessarily like high realistic, we then add the adversarial objective to it, because this is kind of the more, we found that this is the most stable way to do to train this model. And yeah, as an illustration of what this actually gives us, we can look at reconstructions of this squirrel that I was talking about as a motivation. So if we look at this paw of the squirrel here, we see that for a standard discrete VAE, which is not using perceptual loss or adversarial training, we see that the oval structure is actually good, but the local details are blurred out and the texture of the stone is not crisp. So this does not look like a realistic image, I would say, like a realistic natural image. And when we instead train this VQGAN paradigm that I introduced, with like the same latent capacity, we achieve a very good reconstruction and realistic looking texture. And what this additionally gives us is that we can increase the compression level even further. And we still have a realistic looking fur, although the pose and shape is not perfectly aligned with the input anymore. Okay, so this is basically the first stage training. And in this work, like in taming transformers, we were training transformer models as the generative model in the second stage. And to do this, doing this is then actually really straightforward. So once we have the VGKN trained, you encode your training images through the encoder, which gives you this discrete grid of codebook entries. You enroll them into a 1D sequence, and then you can train an autoregressive transformer on the sequences, kind of top left to bottom right. And it's also easy to make this model a conditional model, like a text-to-image model. And one way to do that is to just prepend the conditioning tokens, so text embeddings, for example, to the sequence. Or you could also use an encoder decoder structure to do that. And then use the transformer to model the distribution over the discrete entries, and then decode with the pre-trained decoder back into image space. So yeah, we use that mainly to generate these high-res images of landscapes, because we were kind of compute bottlenecked while being at the research lab. But it's actually pretty cool that Google took this approach and used a slightly modified version of V2GAN, which is based on vision transformers, and trained a large-scale text-to-image model. And they showed that this actually is scalable and can produce really good-looking results. And I think the latest version of that is actually combined with the Imagine upscaler to produce really impressive high-res images. Okay, and so this was kind of the first work in that direction. The second was then high-resolution image synthesis with latent diffusion models, and it shares the motivation with VGKN, basically. So you can kind of view this as exchanging the transformer backbone with a diffusion model, and this gives you certain advantages, which I will talk about in a bit. But one more thing is that you can train this on a VQ embedding, so on a discrete embedding. But the more natural way maybe to do that, and which also gives you slightly better reconstructions in the first stage, is to use a autoencoding architecture which does not have a discrete bottleneck, so not a vector quantization layer, but which is regularized with a KL loss. So this is also what we use then for training stable diffusion. And we just use a very slight regularization to still have good looking reconstructions with good texture, but it ensures that the latent space is not arbitrarily scaled. But like adding the adversarial loss with this dynamic weighting and so on, this is exactly the same as in VQGAN. But there's one more thing that we needed to do because we were interested in text-to-image generation, to actually make diffusion models work for text-to-image generation. There was no architecture at this point which did that. So we came up with this modified architecture. We took OpenAI's ADM model, which was trained for class conditional synthesis on ImageNet, and this model came with self-attention layers in the UNet backbone, and we kind of replaced these self-attention layers with one-layer transformer blocks, which themselves consist of self-attention, cross-attention, and feed-forward layers. And these cross-attention layers helped, or can be used to condition on arbitrary inputs, kind of. So one of them is like the natural way to condition on text is, I would say, cross-attention. So you can use this to condition on the outputs of some other text encoding model, which you can either train jointly with the UNet, or you can also use a pre-trained one like the Clip text encoder that was used in Stable Diffusion, or some D5 encoder, or anything else. And these are some text-to-image outputs that were actually then generated with Stable Diffusion. So Stable Diffusion is an instance of a latent diffusion model. It uses this architecture that I just introduced. Stable Diffusion uses a fixed clip text encoder to do that. And yeah, I didn't generate these samples. I collected them from a Discord server because there are people who can do this way better than me. But yeah, it has been really impressive to see what people can actually do with this model. And maybe one important kind of ingredient that I didn't mention yet is that these models only work when they are combined, like work well, only when they're combined with something that's called classifier-free diffusion guidance. And this is kind of a cheat code that was introduced by Jonathan Ho and Tim Salmons. And intuitive explanation of what it does is during the diffusion, during the denoising process, it pushes the model away from an unspecified or an unconditional model towards the conditioning signal, so towards the text that you give it. And this means that this process actually needs this unconditional model, which might seem like a disadvantage at a first glance, but actually it's really easy to implement this by dropping out the conditional signal at a certain rate. So for Stable Diffusion, we drop this 10% of the time during training. And this also comes only with a small additional cost at inference, because these scores, these model outputs, can be computed in parallel, or if like your memory is restricted, you can also compute them sequentially, but then it's a little slow. And yeah, here we see some outputs for S equals to 1, according to this classifier-free guidance formula. 1 means that this is actually the standard diffusion case without this guidance. And we see like, okay, this doesn't look like a good looking generation. The prompt here was a panda eating fries in a restaurant. But if we turn up the value of this guidance scale, we actually arrive at something that looks like a panda eating fries in a restaurant, right? So this is super important to actually have this in the model. But yeah, Stable Diffusion is not restricted to, it cannot only do pure text to image synthesis, but it could also do in painting. And the nice thing about this is you can, and I think Justin already talked about this, is you can actually take the pre-trained model and fine tune it for these different tasks. So in painting is one instance of this. You can then, because it's text conditional, the nice feature is that you can actually control what you want to have generated in the masked area. Another is semantic synthesis. We recently published a model that is conditioned on monocular depth estimates. So this gives you something that is a model that is really shape preserving. So you can give it an input image, infer this depth estimate with, it's actually using another neural network, and then condition the model on that. And yeah, as you can see, the shapes are really preserved for this one. And another version is upscaling, which is also very easy to implement, but just giving it a low resolution image. And there's one more nice application, which was not possible before when doing the transformer-based approach, which is image-to-image or image-to-image translation. And this is based on something that was introduced in a paper called SD Edit. And it's a very simple recipe. So given some initial image, you would add noise to this initial image according to the diffusion schedule that you use to train the model. And this destroys some information from the from your initial image, but then you can actually reword this process with the pre-trained model, and using different text prompts, you can try to steer what the output looks like. So the cool thing about this is that it doesn't need like additional training, but can just be applied with a pre-trained diffusion model. And yeah, I did this initially with this sketch here of this landscape that I came up with. And it's actually really cool that you can control the style of the generation by simply changing the text prompt. So we can do a watercolor painting of a fantasy landscape. We can do a digital artwork by just changing to trending on ArtStation, or specify certain artists and so on. And yeah, this was I have to admit, unexpectedly popular, but I think it's really cool to see that this is can be used in such creative ways. So, for example, it was used to upgrade your child's artwork. There were a lot of interesting Twitter threads on that. And also, yeah, I just found it interesting how many creative applications people came up with. This is not actually not based on image-to-image, but just text-to-image. But just this text-to-color palette application where you could just enter an emotion or some abstract concept and get a color palette out of that is, I think, a very nice application, actually, of text-to-image models. People combined this with other techniques, for example, for video stylization. Then there was this, there are like even more websites right now like this, but the one that popped up pretty quickly was lexicon.art, which is kind of a library for samples generated with Stable Diffusion, and you can browse it and check the hyperparameters that were used to generate the samples and try to use this as an inspiration, maybe. It was really interesting to see this how many plugins and UIs popped up and ports to TensorFlow cameras ran on a Mac pretty quickly. It was used for lossy image compression, and also super interesting actually to see this being used increasingly used as a benchmark for different inference engines and so on. Yeah, and what's next with this? I don't know how long like this specific Stable Diffusion architecture will be around, but I guess one very interesting direction that I'm excited about is actually making this faster doing inference, because this has lots of practical applications, I think, for mostly all of the different creative applications that we've seen. And one way to do that is by distilling the model into a few step denoiser model. And yeah, I'm actually happy to announce that we are working on that, that there's a collaboration going on with Chen Lin, who had a nice paper on distillation of guided diffusion models, and we applied that to Stable Diffusion, and there's good performance already with four steps only. And this model also folds this classifier-free guidance step into the model by simply, or by additionally distilling the classifier-free guidance step into a single step that is conditioned on the guidance scale. So this also decreases the costs actually of doing that. Yeah, and I think this is an interesting direction. Maybe it can be pushed even further. So yeah, that was my overview. Credits go out to like all the amazing collaborators, Patrick, Andreas, Dominic, Björn from the research lab. Of course, Hugging Face for the support and so on, and all these open source libraries. So thanks for having me.
Thank you so much, Robin. Really nice talk. I think Jono has some questions to share.
Yeah, well, first off, you heard it here, folks. Distilled Stable Diffusion coming soon. Robin, thanks for sharing that. Yeah, I guess I had a question on sort of where you're thinking of looking next. I know you came from this transformer-based approach first to the latent diffusion models. Are you thinking that diffusion is going to be the way forward, or has Party sparked some thinking that maybe the transformer approach might be interesting? Is there a hybrid like Paella where you could do like a diffusion-inspired like multi-step inference with transformers? What are your sort of research interests going beyond like the fine-tuning Stable Diffusion?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, good question. So yeah, I think there are two directions. So one of them is actually distillation, making this fast is super interesting, and then it's becoming really hard in the few step regime, and improving that, making it a real-time application, I think would be super nice, like retaining the generalization abilities of the original model, but having it in real time would be nice. So this is like one direction. The other is we see all these different fine-tuned dream booth models. I think there are over 5,000 on Hugging Face already. 5,000 checkpoints, which is insane. And maybe there's a way of actually getting kind of this performance without needing to fine tune. So I think this is also a super interesting direction.
Right, so something like what Justin is doing, where you're adding additional capabilities of not just depth conditioning, but maybe conditioning on images, conditioning on faces.
Yeah, exactly.
Awesome.
We've actually got a question from the audience, if that's okay, we could share.
Oh, yes, we've got a minute or two. Yeah, perfect.
So the question is from Paul, who's asking, is there like a direction to sort of add numeracy? So can you, for example, have something like a painting with 9 apples? And I think in general, this idea of like compositionality and you know, numeracy is kind of like a, as far as I know, kind of an open problem. Do you have some sort of thoughts there about, you know, how we might integrate that information?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the directions is to use increasingly powerful text encoders. I think the Imagine paper already showed that this is possible. The other is maybe you could combine this with like this conditioning techniques. You could condition on, let's say, the output of an object detector or something like that, which actually detects the objects and then is able to count them. And then you could modify this by like specifying the number of things that you want to have. So maybe these are like 2 different ways of doing that.
Awesome. So I think it's time for your compatriot, Patrick, to join the party. So thank you so much again, Robin. It's a real pleasure to hear from the creator of Stable Diffusion.
Sure. Thanks for the invite.
And see you next time.
Yep, see you. Bye.
Okay.
Great. All right. To introduce our next speaker, Patrick Esser is a principal research scientist at Runway, focused on machine learning for creative applications. So he was also a developer of Stable Diffusion and VQGAN, part of that same Confers group at University of Heidelberg. So Patrick, so great to have you here. And I'm really looking forward to seeing some of the applications that you're working on and also, just all your other thoughts on what you've been doing with these incredible models.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Can everybody hear me?
Yep, it's perfect.
Perfect. And I think I can go through the slides in here, right? Yep, nice. Thanks for having me. Really glad to be here. My talk is called Food for Diffusion. Basically, I just want to talk. Well, I guess like the one point is to talk a bit, to give a bit of food for thought also, what one can work with on diffusion models. But the other part of the title is basically that I will talk a bit about the inputs to the model and how that affects the output. So essentially, what I want to start with is that composition is something that matters a lot for aesthetics. So here, this is a nice example, I guess, from Moonrise Kingdom by, which always has like really nice compositions. And this is in a way where it really becomes kind of clear that there is something going on, something specific about the composition of the frames. While still being beautiful. So I think this will be generally quite a hard goal to reach that kind of quality in the aesthetics, how scenes are composited. But I think it's definitely something we should strive for. And while those are not generated, they've been made by a human master, at least like, something like the first slide, that is generated. Yeah, so basically for composition, I guess I'm not really an expert in the topic, but I guess like you could on a high level say that the relative position of different objects in a scene that make up the image, it matters, right? So on a very, very basic level, you have to think about like positions in images. Mm. Yeah, I think one should also say, like, even though we train on huge databases like Lion, which come from everywhere and contain all kinds of different content, one should still realize that it's like, we don't take, even those pictures are not random, right? Like, even people like me who are not aware of good compositions or anything, even if I take a picture, I usually take a picture of some object. So what we can generally expect is that images will be object-centric, for example. Already puts like a weak bias into the data set. And the question is then really kind of like, okay, how can the model actually figure out where to put objects, be that for matching the object-centric prior, or be that for coming up with good compositions. So kind of like as a thought experiment, if you want, is the idea like, imagine you're a convolution, like usually our, for example, for image diffusion models, the backbone of the diffusion model is often a unit, which mainly consists of convolutions. Not completely true, we also use attention most of the time. Nevertheless, if you look at the basic operation of a convolution, it's like you use a fixed set of weights and slide that over the window, right? So you apply the same function, so to say, to every point in the image. You slide it across. So now with a diffusion model, if you sample, eventually, like, your first step will start from a pure noise image as shown on the top right here, right? So if you're a convolution kind of, and you get your input, which really consists only of noise, and you see two different noise patterns, it's basically impossible for you to tell where you are in the image. Like, two patches in here, they just look absolutely the same. So basic question is actually like, how, well, we know that it works, right? Like, we do get object-centric samples out of the model. So the question is actually like, where does that come from? And there's really nice work about this by Islam et al. In a bit of a different context, not for generative models, but for discriminative models, which analyzes, first of all, like how much position information convolutional networks encode, and also analyze the mechanisms of how that works. And yeah, I guess like one of the, on a high level, the high level finding or one of the conclusions is that one way that CNNs do get positional or do encode positional information is through a combination of having a large receptive field and the fact that we often use zero padding for, in combination with this, for convolutions, right? So here's a visualization of that principle, basically. So if compared to the previous slide, we now have a model that has a larger receptive field. And then if you're at some point in your image, you want to apply your convolutional kernel there, but the problem becomes like it might be bigger than the image, right? And so the simplest solution is to just add zeros in that position. And so if you do that, as visualized here with the black borders, basically, you see that now those two, like what a convolution sees in those two different locations, actually does differ. Like now it sees, oh, on the left there's a black border, so I'm probably somewhere on the left side of the image. And similarly for the right patch, you can see that there is a black bar on the bottom, so I know I'm somewhere close to the bottom. And of course, like, since all of this is learned, it might come up with very sophisticated ways how that encodes the position. Yeah, so with this kind of like idea of how actually like a CNN and thereby also probably a diffusion model actually orients itself or like thinks about compositions in samples and images, I want to digress a little bit and go towards textures, right? So textures, I would say, are a bit different from our typical images in the sense that here it's, you wouldn't say there's no like real object prior in the images. In fact, I think one of the things that is like a helpful description is kind of like that they look pretty much the same everywhere, right? Like you can look at any patch and they kind of look very similar, at least like often in a statistical sense. And yeah, so in that case, it might actually like clash a bit with the idea of having position encoded because you want to look at the same. And also, yeah, one also makes use of that idea that textures kind of look the same everywhere if you want to generate large textures, right? Often this will be like a large area that you want to paint, be that in a 3D asset or whatever, you need to create like potentially arbitrarily large textures. So there are a lot of works on, or like the most basic idea is that since it looks everywhere the same, you can just take like a small patch and then you just tile it, arrange it next to each other to get a larger texture. And so one could try to do that essentially with samples. Like a nice thing that does work very well with like text to diffusion models, you might say like as a prompt, you just ask for a texture patch of wood, right? Here shown on the right is the result that you get out. And it kind of makes sense. It might make for a nice nice texture if you can increase the size. But if you do that now, you just tile it as shown on the left side, you can clearly see that there are like, yeah, you can clearly see that it is tiled, right? So that's not very desirable. It doesn't really look good. There is still basically, I would say there are two issues. One is that like the spatially, it's not homogeneous enough. So there is still quite a bit of structure in the image, which might come from something like zero padding, which a model knows. And the other one is the blending around the edges, right? And yeah, like I said, this has been, I mean, it's has been extensively analyzed and there are many algorithms for that, for doing proper texture tiling. And one approach is, was described in his work by Heitz on high performance by example noise using a histogram preserving blending operator, which I think is really popular for texture tiling. It performs often very well. I think it's just that it makes like, again, very rather strong assumptions that what you that the image actually can be described well by its statistic. And yeah, if we apply something like this, now shown on the left, the result is definitely improved. It looks much more natural, the boundaries. But generally speaking, one can still see like this structure of a 2x3 grid, right? Just because there's so much residual structure left. So yeah, if one takes a look at this like padding behavior, and if one thinks about that, this might be one of the core things how the model thinks about position. And we want to get a more homogeneous texture out of it. A very simple idea is to just replace. You have an existing model. And you just replace the padding mechanism in all of your convolutional layers to do like a circular padding. And what you get out of that is then basically your sample becomes something like here, shown on the bottom right. And without any post-processing, so the image on the left doesn't use any blending, you just tile them together and you see that they actually fit, which is, yeah, which is a really nice property, because now you can directly generate those textures and have them directly tileable, right? Without any post-processing and also without any real changes to the model. Yeah, so I think I really like this example because it's, I would say, rather simple, like both in terms of you can take an existing model and just apply the change, and all of a sudden you get samples with completely different properties just by thinking a bit about how the model internally works. And yeah, maybe the other thing that really surprised me for this example is that it actually works, right? Like often I would say you have some intuition about how the model works regarding like the padding. But now in this example, yeah, we go in and directly manipulate the way how that is handled, right? And that changes like everything internally, all the internal representations of the model. And just the fact that this still works is quite surprising, because I think there are so many examples where you can really mess up the model performance really quickly just by changing slight details. Like I had issues where like I would train a model with a very specific resampling algorithms for resizing training examples, and at test time, if you would use any other, it would like completely fail. So very often there is this fact that models can overfit to specifics very strongly, but in this case, it really performs nicely and produces the desired result. Okay, the training data kind of brings me to my second point that I wanted to talk about, which now goes again back to what we started with, and which is kind of the opposite of textures, that usually there is compositional structure in images. So what we see here is basically the first page that you find if you go to the website of the Lion aesthetics dataset for a relatively high aesthetics threshold. And you see it in their original form, right? Like all the images have different aspect ratios. They also have different resolutions. They're just resized for visualization. But I guess the important thing is like, they usually have very different aspect ratios. And the other thing to note is that actually more often than not, they are not square, right? I guess like the two most popular formats are basically like either like a landscape format, something like this, which is like a white screen aspect ratio, or also like a portrait mode, which is especially popular for portraits, right? But also for other images. And I mean, I would say that a lot of those images come from artists who actually created them. And I mean, they usually put thought into like how they arrange objects in an image, right? That is part of what the image should express. So I think that's actually quite important data. But if you then look at what we actually do quite often when we train those models, it's like, I would say, basically a simple technical artifact that we want to stack all our training examples into a single tensor to have a good memory layout that we can feed it through the network fast, right? We want to already takes long enough, so you have to make sure the performance is good. So to make that possible, this stacking of images, what we usually do, we just extract square images, resize them to a common size, and we get a batch that, for this example, basically then looks like that. I mean, the images still look good from a first perspective, but yeah, like I said, I think like in this example, it's not even that bad. Like, but we can often see like here already indicated that heads get a little bit cut off here, and there are no more hands visible. And yeah, here the composition completely changes, where we did see something of the background behind the bars here. So yeah, I think it really changes the whole meaning, or definitely destroys the composition of the intended original image, right? And okay, as a consequence of what happens if we do that, right? So we do this fixed size training, and then what we see, like as a first observation, just regarding the generalization, is that okay, so we train on typically here, this model is also trained on 512 by 512, at this resolution we get reasonably good images. Like, I did not excessively cherry pick those here. This one's definitely not perfect, but you can see like it overall gets the gist, and if you produce like quite a few more samples, you usually find pretty good ones as well. But then you try to do something else, right, during sampling time. It's, in general, it's one of the nice things of a convolutional model, that you can just like change the shape during inference and produce samples at different resolutions. Yeah, and I think this is relatively interesting what happens here. You can see often, if you go to like higher resolutions, you very often see this repeated objects floating around somewhere in the image. And once again, I think like if you think back to the fact that the model usually does encode the boundary it was trained on, like it knows like there is a 512 by 512 is what I'm training at. And most of the time I do expect an object, like a person or something, in the middle of that image, right? And that's basically what it's doing here, right? Like, this is double the size. So I guess like the most extreme case would be like if you see like kind of four reasonable images, even though their composition doesn't make sense, right? Like their relationship is just floating around because, 1024 by 1024 image is not a random combination of four 512 by 512 images. So there we really quickly run into trouble in higher resolutions. And something else that we, which is maybe even a bit more surprising, I find, is that the same happens if we go to lower resolutions. Like if we sample this model at 256 by 256 here in the top left, then it actually really doesn't make any sense anymore. So that one's also interesting, like hard to tell what exactly happens. It's like all of a sudden now borders are overlapping, which the model never saw. So yeah, I think that's one of the points where I mean, like, don't expect to get magical generalization to all the cases, right? We see it doesn't. One thing we explored quite a bit now is basically that we train on dynamic sizes. So that means both that we take, we keep the original aspect ratios, which is more about preserving the composition of the scenes, but we also keep all the original resolutions up to a threshold. So we train somewhere between 256 and 2048. What we see is definitely that things improve quite a bit. So for 512 by 512, we still get nice results. In this case also maybe an interesting composition might be related to the different aspect ratios as well. for 2024 by 2024. It also produces good results for 256 by 256. I guess you can see that it's like a bit more, well, I mean, it is a lower resolution image. Also all looks a bit more washy, but that is also actually like a fact of that this is also like a two-stage model, and the first stage also introduces reconstruction errors at lower resolutions. Generally speaking, I don't think you want to go like to something 256 by 256, but it is actually important that you can at least do like one size smaller in case you want to do pretty extreme aspect ratios, right? You want to have, might have like a very long side combined with a very small side. And that brings me also to the other point, which I think is maybe even more interesting, is like this this fact about composing images at different aspect ratios. Here is an example batch for landscape mode on the top. This is the one that was trained on dynamic sizes and dynamic aspect ratios. You can see that it produces quite nice results often, and it also seems to have some, I mean, I don't want to judge that. I'm not, like I said, not an expert, but I think it's can also be used to explore nice compositions of most of the time you're interested in probably something like widescreen or different formats. And I think that with something like this, you can, it provides a much better tool to not only explore like the specific content that you want to put somewhere, but also the composition, right? You can get inspired by that as well. Whereas the same model basically with the static size training at 512 by 512, again, we already saw that doesn't make much sense in this case. We again see all those repetitions of objects in the center. Yeah, that one's just basically just the same example, but for portrait mode. I think that's something that also that I hear a lot. People are also a bit annoyed with that often. If you do a portrait mode and you're interested in sampling like a full body person, all kinds of things, funny things happen. Like this one is very common that it just cuts off the head, right? Which is related to what I was talking about in the training batch example. They're just often cut off and we don't see it. So kind of not too useful anymore. And the other one is this duplication of bodies, which sometimes really provide funny looking outputs, but in general, it's also not really what you want, right? Whereas we can see again, I think, especially for this portrait mode with characters, since we train on their original size, I think there are quite a few of those in the training data set. We get much more coherent generations of characters. Yes, let's see about the time. Okay, I think I'm, maybe I will stop here and take questions if there are any.
Awesome, thank you so much, Patrick. That was a really, deep dive into, sort of ways to make diffusion models work, which is pretty nice to see, because a lot of the time you just see the output, right? Like, check out my fancy image on Twitter. And it's actually kind of revealing to see that there's a fair amount of like careful, intuition and engineering that's needed to get this out. We have a few questions from the audience. So one of the ones here from Evan Jones is, based on the way convolutions learn to orient themselves in the image, do you suspect composition is better at the edges but weaker towards the center where the guideposts are fewer?
Yeah, that's a really good question, actually. I think there are two things that one has to differentiate with the composition. One is really this fact that because you crop, you never see the original composition, right? So it's, in that case, if you do the center cropping, it's much, much less common that you actually see like a, in a widescreen image, there would be a widescreen image that you see like a long stretch of nothing. And then maybe at like one third or something of the scene, you have like a portrait, which like, might be like a common composition. So since you never see that, I think like that is one problem why the model would never really, if you ask for a portrait, why it would never really make a long stretch of nothing before it puts a person. Yeah, so from that, I don't think the convolutions are too much involved, but definitely from the perspective of, yeah, orienting itself, I think actually that's, one can go quite a bit deeper into that question and really ask the question like, why are we actually not providing it a better way of orienting itself, right? There is the idea of concatenating coordinates or some representations of the coordinates to the data input, and that can often, like depending on the task, I think it can really improve results. One reason why often why it is not done by default, I think, is because you again even you lose generalization to other resolutions even more, right? Because now the model really starts to use the precise spacing between points, the resolution that you train at. If you change that then during sampling time, it's like really confused. So I think that's why you often don't do it. But I think if we go to dynamic science training, this will be very interesting to explore, to see, because then, yeah, if the model sees all the different resolution grids and different sizes, then we might get the generalization nevertheless.
Thanks. Yeah, it feels a little bit to me like in the space of diffusion models, we're kind of trying to rediscover what are like the techniques from computer vision that we've used for decades. And now what are the equivalent ones, right? Like, you know, we have all these hacks for data augmentation, which work really well. And I think it's pretty much too soon, right, to know exactly, you know, how you do this in the diffusion process.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I think that's super interesting topics. And also on a very high level, I think that's I'm always excited about working with a new technology while reading maybe some older paper and trying to see how those ideas match or can help each other. I think that's super fruitful.
Maybe we can take one tongue-in-cheek question. You know, maybe this question of dynamic training, resizing and stuff, you know, will this fix hands? And maybe a question, like part of that for me has always been like, why, what is it about, you know, Stable Diffusion that gives you these like, you know, nightmarish, like interlocking hands? What's the intuition there? Like, what is it about hands that are like such a difficult thing to do? I mean, I used to be a painter and I used to struggle with like, you know, feet and hands. I hated them. So my own images were always like, you know, hands hidden. But like, is it the same for diffusion models?
Yeah. I mean, actually, I think we already made a bit of progress there, because I mean, it used to be that it was really freaky looking at faces that were generated, and often they still are, but we're getting pretty good at them. I mean, yeah, also there, I think we also talk a lot about that. We definitely think there's this human part where it seems that we're really overly sensitive to human anatomy. So we just notice that so much more than anything else. But then, yeah, I think at least what we saw also a lot when we trained a lot of this, these first stages, right, which try to compress images to a smaller representation and then reconstruct it from there. And I would actually say that already there, we very often observe that, like that faces look very strange and especially hands. And I really think it is also related to the size of those features.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it works better if you ask it for full frontal or close-up portrait, right?
Sure.
Because there's like, essentially, if you look at it relatively, there are now more codes that work to represent the face, then if you have like a face that's very far away, it becomes much smaller, and maybe there's like only a high level, if you look at the receptive field of that code, it might be only a single representation. So yep. So there's more, you have to compress it more, and that's where you lose information and things get worse. So I think that's a big part. And the hands are definitely more, even more difficult due to their size, right? But we'll get there.
Yeah, I mean, I think already in Stable Diffusion 2, you can see great improvements. So yeah. This is it's pretty exciting. You know, that the great mystery of hands will be solved.
The biggest problem of our times.
You know, some people are, you know, doing protein modeling and, you know, climate change, and we're worried about hands.
Yeah, hands consist of proteins. So.
So, yeah, with that, I'd like to thank you again, Patrick, for joining us. It's been a real pleasure. And, we'll see you at the next event or around.
Thank you so much. It was really nice to meet you.
Bye.
Great. By the way, we'll try and make sure, I think, that there'll be links to all of these people in descriptions of the videos and things like that, so that you can go and find the amazing work that's happening at Runway, or just follow up with these people, find them on Twitter, see what's coming next. Okay, and speaking of keeping up with things, our final guest for the evening or morning, wherever you are, is Apolinario Passo. Apolinario is a machine learning engineer, or machine learning art engineer, I believe is the title, at Hugging Face, and he's also an artist who focuses on generative art and generative media. And for me, the platform that he founded, multimodal.art, and the company Twitter account and things, it's just a really amazing resource in terms of, especially for people who are trying to keep up with the space but don't necessarily have time to be, you know, tracking all of these different sources. Apolinario has done a really great job of bringing the community together and kind of curating and keeping track of what's happening and sharing that with people with a very infectious enthusiasm. So really great to have you here, Apolinario, and I'm really looking forward to hearing what comes after the hype.
You're muted, Polly.
Sorry. Hi, everyone. Thanks for the introduction. And so I'm here to talk about how diffusion models are cool. I think we've been through many talks that show how they're cool. And there is a lot of a generative media hype right now. I think more and more people are jumping. People are raising kind of big rounds by implementing these technologies. There are lots of lower hanging fruits. A lot of people jumping into this space. This is amazing. So I'd like to give a panorama and look into the future a little bit, of course, with our sparse knowledge. This first image here is actually an analogy of diffusion models that I like to make. Because if we think about diffusion models, when you start from random noise and you end up into an image, it's kind of like this quotation by Michelangelo that in the block of stone, he removes everything that is not stone to make the angel, right? And this quotation is false, of course, like everything on the internet, but I still like the analogy, so that's why I include this image every talk I make. I have this slide here to go very quickly on how diffusion models work, just to give a ground. But I think the GIF is already played. So basically the way diffusion models work on a very high level is that you train a model to go from signal to noise. You add noise to an image, so you go into this direction, and then you train the model to go back into the other direction. So from random noise, it kind of finds the image behind the noise. If you want to learn more, of course, you can join the diffusion models course. That is the motivation of this whole event here. But before talking about the future, I'd like to talk a little bit about the past. Before software, creative media required manual and ultra specialized work to come to life, right? Like film editing, it required someone literally with a scissor cutting the film, right? And then gluing them together. And you had like quite skilled people that would actually glue them together in very specific ways or do seamless cuts. And this was a skill, this was a profession, this was just a required step for making film, right? Like you had the film, you had to cut it, you had to like process it, and that there was no way around it until software, right? Like, when you think about software, when you think about computers, and we can think of all the revolution that was brought up, but with software, essentially, skilled professionals can bring creative works to life faster, right? So the idea that someone might have thought of cutting it could not be applicable, and now it is, and way more cutting and the editing techniques are available because of this, and this allows for huge productions with a lot of visual effects that were only dreams of the techniques that were manual or that were not digital, that were analog. And when the barrier of entry lowered, a creative explosion arose. So I took this chart of movies released per year, and I found like the year that digital cameras and Adobe Premiere were kind of, I said invented, but it's really like released digital cameras and Adobe Premiere. And we can see a creative explosion, right? So basically you had a limited amount of people that could do film, that could produce creative output in the film format. And with the digital revolution, essentially everyone can, with access to a camera and to a computer, could learn the skill, but it's still a skill that you have to learn. But we can see that way more films were produced. So maybe the person that had the profession of cutting the film, actually potentially that job became very niche, but the overall film editing profession grew way more, right? So, well, what if instead of days, it took seconds to, or minutes to create? And everyone, I think, watching this talk may be familiar that DALL-E showed the world text to image was possible, but that was just the beginning. Stable Diffusion showed the potential of this technology when it goes open source, and how it can be simplified with libraries like diffusers. And now we're in an era of a community customization of models. So people are doing dream booth, textual inversion, and other techniques. And in less than 1 hour, you can train a model. And yeah, there's even a newer technique that you can train in only one image called Dream Artist. So it's a pretty nice way to customize the model. So that gives us a glimpse on the fact that these models are open source released and the community has jumped in, and now people are customizing it on different things. I also recommend to watch this video by Corridor Digital. It's very cool. They essentially use dream booths and a bunch of other visual techniques to create the Spider-Man from Spider-Verse into the whole Marvel Cinematic Universe. So this also gives a glimpse on how this could be used professionally in the future. But I would like to get a bit into some of the philosophical debates, if I may. And I really like this kind of Twitter thread. It's a bit old if you see it, April 8th, but I think it's still interesting. On one hand, we have someone saying that DALL-E broke their heart because in this person's perspective, this kind of technique of text to image and broader would destroy visual art because basically it would essentially create so much of it that we wouldn't be able to differentiate beauty or to differentiate he even gives the analogy of the more destructive than what the internet did to music, right? So from this person's perspective, essentially just by creating an unlimited-ish amount of 3D images or images that are tuned to our brain to find catchy, right? In the same way a music is catchy, for some people may not correlate to it being good. Some people are worried that by making catchy or very beautiful looking images instantly, we would overload the world with beauty. And when everything's beautiful, nothing is beautiful, right? So there is one side of this debate. And on the other side of this debate, there is Claire Silver, which is a digital artist that also uses generative models, that says that actually these tools allow for creativity without the barrier of skill. That makes everyone an artist, essentially. So saying that the skill and the labor and the work is not the soul of art. The soul of art is the creative expression, and these models enable everyone to express themselves creatively. Right? I think those are two sides of an argument that exist in the world. And I won't take sides on this particular slide because I think it's worth for people to reflect on. Because in one hand, I do think that we, when this is used on advertisement industry, we'll see a saturation of beauty, let's put it that way. But on the other hand, I do think that empowering people to create is amazing. Yeah. So yeah, and I think on the same capacity, another big debate there is whether this technology will create more jobs or it will remove more jobs. I bring this creating more jobs here because a lot of people are talking about so many professions that could potentially be replaced by this kind of technology. But I re-invite everyone to look at this chart again, because in the same way I think that when digital cameras and Adobe Premiere came together, this exploded the production of things, right? I do think that when this technology is matured enough to be on everyone's devices, there's so many new content, new productions being made that a whole new industry might boom. And in the same way that YouTube, for example, is a platform where people can kickstart their own thing and reach an audience, I believe that an analogous process or a curve even more exponential than this could just create way more a whole new economy, right? So maybe in the same way that the job of the person cutting the film disappeared, but the overall video editing jobs actually got way more. I do think that even if we don't know the names or how to frame them yet, that just the creative explosion this is bringing about and how much more content can be produced, how many more people can express themselves, would lead to potentially more jobs in this overall economy, despite maybe some operational processes being challenged in a way. But at the same time, it's kind of unavoidable that this technology is getting embedded into tools that designers use. So I do think that it's a co-creation process that in some areas may need slightly less professionals, but overall, I think it can boom a new economy with more people participating than before. And yeah, I think overall, it's just a radically different world we're going to live in because, imagine the kids saying that we're so old that computers didn't even know how to draw when we grew up, right? So when this is baseline, right, when this technology is the basis for things, when this is obvious that computers can do it, we will start operating on other layers, right? So right now, this technology is impressive to us. We want to improve it. We want to make video. We want to make audio. Once this is like baseline, we'll not be thinking so much about the medium, right? I think a lot of this technology is about the medium, and you do like a frog jumping from a building with the clothes of Superman just because you want to make sure. Like, I think these crazy problems are in part us wanting to make sure that those images were not in the data set, right? Like that it's really creating. But once we overcome that and we really use this into our creative process, there is a radically different world, I believe, that is about to come. And I'm taking a few wild guesses here about what could potentially come. And one thing that we can see converging is automatic script generation with the language models, and then video generation as well. So you can imagine a script being written by an AI, and then the script becoming a whole video animation by an AI, and then all the voices acting also being generated by an AI. And if we combine this together, you could think of a Netflix that is custom. Right, so we could think of something like you have TV shows or series that are generated for you, right? And some people may think that's amazing. Some people may think that's horrible. Some people may think, oh, this will create even echo chambers of size one, right? But I do think that there are, that this is a possibility that we could have generative, customized, and maybe even together. Let's say you and your partner, it makes a TV show that both of you like, so it's like combines the tastes of the two of you, or a group of friends. So yeah, I think the possibilities are endless, but I do think that auto-generated end-to-end content based on your taste is something that could be in the horizon, and for some is a utopia, hedonistic utopian, for others can be like a nightmare. So up to you, but I think something in this capacity could exist. Another one is, and by the way, this image was generated by Stable Diffusion 2, so quite like it. I do think that social media wouldn't have to look radically different to support a world where everyone is creating, right? Like imagine just the volume of content created by the imagination of people with these tools. I'm not sure that the current social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, or even like the messaging apps like WhatsApp would support not support technically, maybe they could increase their bandwidth, but I'm talking about UX, UI, like would the platforms that exist today be compatible with a world where everyone is creating, everyone is being creative? I think not, and I think new platforms would, if the current platforms don't adapt, they could be leapfrogged by new platforms that have this in their core, right? So I think that's something that we will have to see, but it's another point that I believe could make sense in the future. And yeah, I would like to end here to open for questions and to ask what you create, and happy to take questions from the audience and also reflect a little bit on the points that I brought.
Awesome. Thanks, Polly, for this provocative talk. There's a question here it's more of a comment than maybe a question, but we can turn it into a question. So it's from Shubham, who says, you know, at some point we can imagine that, you know, these sort of generated images are going to be almost as good or indistinguishable from, you know, the ones that humans have made. And I guess it's sort of asking, like, maybe, like, one, does it matter? And two, like, do we want to sort of aim or optimize for a future where that is the case? Or, you know, what's your thoughts on, like, you know, the future of, like, a lot of, say, Google search suddenly now returning generated images versus, you know, human generated ones?
Yeah, I think that's a very provocative question. And I would say there is a twofold answer to it. One is that indeed, I think very soon we'll be failing this Turing test of whether or not what we're seeing is an AI-generated image or a real picture. Although I think our brains are very good at being adversarial in that, so I think it will be a bit of a cat and rat catch game for a bit, but I do think at the end it will blend in. But I do believe that actually, and it's a bit of a side tangent from the question, but I do believe that there is a side to this, which is, I do think that new art styles by humans will emerge on the figures of these models. So basically, we can think of what can Stable Diffusion not do? Hands, right? So like, let's say drawing hands grows in popularity or something like that. Of course, hands is a dumb example, but I do believe that there will be a bit of an adversarial game between human artists and this AIs, and we might see, because once the AI generated content is everywhere, media, advertising, Google search, etc., I do think this will create an opportunity for artists to say, how can I create something that is radically different from the entire universe of what this AI can do? And I think there will be a set that is outside of that, right, that humans could explore. At least temporarily. Then someone goes and trains the AI into that whatever new thing, and it becomes like a game. But I do believe that if we get saturated, people will try to overcome the saturation, be it with human-created stuff or AI-created stuff. But I wouldn't say we should. I mean, I do think that as humans are very adaptable to things in a way, in the sense of it can be like some people can like the, oh, it's if we cannot distinguish, it's the end of things, you know, like we've heard this kind of like doomsday prophecies before, and they may have some truth to them, but I do think we're very adaptable, and once we taken as true that okay, like generative art or media and real photos are now indistinguishable in the same way that Photoshop artists can do really indistinguishable images from real ones, and we still have like social cues to distinguish things, like very unlikely a reputable newspaper will publish a Photoshopped image of a real event, right? I think we will create social structures to make sure that the source of things and where things come from and who posted it and how this came about. I'm not too worried about that, but I do think that we need to socially build the structures together, because it's not only about the output, right? Mm. It's about the whole infrastructure.
Yeah, totally. And we saw in Devi's talk actually this discussion about, you know, the data set and how do you construct data sets that are in, you know, some way fair to the artists? And it's like a kind of sociological question, right? So I have another question maybe for myself, which is one of the things that's like surprising about diffusion models is that for someone like myself who lives in Transformer land, it kind of came out of nowhere. So, you know, I was happy going along with large language models, NLP, and now a little bit of multimodal stuff. And then boom, you know, Stable Diffusion kind of lands, right? And there were these like hints of like, you know, Clip and Glide. And of course we knew DALL-E from OpenAI. And the question I have for you is like, why do you think it took so long, so to speak, to go from like, you know, these sort of original diffusion papers, some of them which I think are quite old, like, you know, maybe even 10 years, to get to where we are now? Because it doesn't seem like it was like, oh, we needed like, you know, the Transformer or something to make this work. It's more like, you know, this kind of Frankenstein combination of existing tools. And I was just curious what you thought on that is. Like, was it a surprise to you as someone who's been in the generative art scene, you saw this coming, or was it something that also, you know, kind of surprised you?
Yeah, so I think the first paper that I know of for diffusion models is from 2016, which is like ages ago on the space, right? And it's very interesting because it was like an exploratory process of, oh, we can use this technique from thermodynamics, because diffusion models like are called diffusion models because of gas diffusions, right? Like some people may not be aware of that, but when like basically in the original diffusion models paper, they train the model to like basically take a 2D plane and imagine if a gas was like spreading from an S shape from this 2D plane and like train it to go back to the shape, because gases are chaotic in nature, right? Like usually they go everywhere. So denoising this process is hard. And they tried to use it as a machine learning technique. And it was kind of like a cool experiment, got some traction at the time, but it didn't perform better than anything that was state of the art at the time. So people, it went kind of dormant. And then I think it revived around 2019 with Jonathan Ho's paper on DBIM. And essentially that recreated interest into it. And I think it was kind of, I think there was like this small winter, let's say, of like 3 years, little interest. But since this paper, I think the interest picked up. And because I think in this paper, it was already a bit competitive to what GANs would do and how GANs would work. So I do think this technique was like not right, not necessarily with Transformers, but like a bit with the GANs. But I do think that what transformed kind of everything in this space was the DALL-E 1 blog post and code and paper, because I think just the framework that you could condition generative models in general in text was something that was explored very minimally, and no one really thought it was anywhere close to being like high quality, right? Like to type in a text and fully generate the image. Like maybe you could drive in some directions, and some people are thinking of this with the GANs, like style GANs and stuff. But really, the release of Clip and the general OpenAI thing of DALL-E transformed this, I think, and it kind of created I think Robin's and Patrick work, like VQGAN combined with Clip, and then images starting being generated. And then OpenAI picked up on the diffusion model work for with their paper called Diffusion's Bit GAN on image synthesis, and that brought a lot of attention. And then, yeah, people from the generative media community, like Catherine Krausen, hooked together this model, right? Like the diffusion and Clip. And this Clip guided diffusion process showed that diffusion had a lot of potential for generative media. And then OpenAI picked up from that with the Glide, and then DALL-E 2 and the Google and Stable Diffusion also picked up on those works. So I do believe that there was a convergence in time. But yeah, I think it's like with many of the things in science are a bit mimetic in the sense of the ideas that pick up because of other ideas. And the technique was there, dormant, but I think it emerged in the time where it made sense also from GPU. Some people even say it arrived too early, in a sense, because we, like, if we were in a new iteration of GPUs when this technique existed, this could have seen a different explosion because more people could train it on their own hardware, because it's like, it's not accessible to train. So if this creates like a scenario that we see where big organizations, even if they're nice big organizations, like Hugging Face or Stability AI that train things for open source, still not that other big organizations are not nice, but just the ones that release things open source versus not, but you still require, like, you cannot train state-of-the-art model in your house like you could do with a GAN, right? So I think it came into the right time where it was possible to make a model with the quality that existed. So it, in a way, kind of balances out, like even with neural networks, right? Like there's a lot of people asking this question on why it took so long to pick up, given this always existed in computer science history. But
I guess it's like the thing we were talking with David, that, you know, the criteria is, can it run on Colab? And that's like a great, you know, unlocking of you know, use and creativity. I think maybe we should switch now to the final talk from David Ha. So this is, he gave it live earlier today, but we'll replay it now. So those of you who didn't have a chance to join can see it. So thanks a lot, Polly. See you at work. And now I'm going to, let's see if I can share my screen. Let's see. So if I'm not mistaken, you should see this video, and maybe Polly can just confirm when I play it that you can hear it.
To see what all of our guests have to share with us, which brings me, I guess, to introducing the first speaker. So very much a warm welcome to David Ha. Until recently, David was a researcher at Google on the Google Brain team in Japan. But just in the last few months, he has switched over and is now head of strategy at Stability AI. So very excited to hear from him. And his research interests are, you know, complex systems and self-organization, and also just all of these creative applications of machine learning. So David, very great to have you, and I look forward to seeing what you have to share with us.
Well, thank you. I'm going to share my slide now. Can you see my full screen slide?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thanks. Thanks a lot, Hugging Face, for your kind introduction and for... gone by. This space is happening. There's so much going on right now. Things are going really fast. And before joining Stability AI, I worked at Google Brain as a researcher for 6 years. And in this talk, I really want to dive in the topic about collective intelligence and how that is related to creative AI. And the material in this talk sprang from a conversation between myself and my collaborator, Dr. Judy Fan, who's also a machine learning advent of text-to-image models, diffusion models, and things are happening at such a fast speed that I always question, and I was discussing with Judith earlier this year, what's going on? We want to make sense of it. And we had lots of discussions. We dive into some of the literature in behavioral studies in the past, and I think we really have to understand how people in general, the population or the collective intelligence is using these technologies and interacting with them to really understand how why things are going so rapidly and things are being adapted and such an exciting space. So in this talk, I'm gonna mainly focusing on my experiences with this technology and through understanding the collective intelligence or how people collectively use it, it might help us develop a framework for understanding how these text-to-image models or more broadly AI tools augments human creative expression. And they help us understand why things are really taking off this year. So let's dive in. So I really like to study complex systems and collective intelligence because I think these systems are beautiful and they lead to lots of resilience and robust properties. One of my favorite quotes is from this book from Andrew Pickering in The Cybernetic Brain, where he mentions that bridges and buildings are all designed to be indifferent to their environment, to withstand fluctuations and not to adapt to them. The best bridge is one just stands there, whatever the weather. So I think the contrast between a really well-built bridge versus a bridge that's built by a bunch of agents, in this case ants, that were formed through immersions is a sharp one. And it's a metaphor for what's going on in the technology space right now. So on one hand, you have very large structured models that are designed to do things really well. And on the other hand, you can have open source models or people, hundreds or thousands of people hacking around models, taking them apart and making things out of them. So I think these two approaches is kind of at the core of what's happening in the open source community right now. And it's gonna be a theme of this talk. And when I think about image generation from a collective intelligence, we can think about GANs or VAEs or Stable Diffusion. But one experiment I really like is the image generation experiments using humans as an algorithm on Reddit in this R place experiment. So this is, if you haven't heard of R place before, it's basically collective intelligence applied to image generation. It happens around once a year on some years. And they basically set up a 1,000 by 1,000 pixel canvas. So there's a million pixels. And each Reddit user is only allowed to draw one pixel every 5 minutes, and the entire experiment lasts for a week. So the user, in terms of the exploration space, has a million times 256 possible color possibilities. So there's a wide range of exploration space. From the user's point of view, the user also wants to share and collaborate with other users. And what's more interesting is the network dynamics also affects what is drawn. as well. So there's three properties: the exploration space, there's also the drive to share and to act in the environments, and for the user to get feedback from this complex network in this million pixel canvas. So what happens is the users on Reddit, without any explicit reward signal even, coordinate some strategy on the Reddit discussion forum to defend some design, to attack other designs, and to form alliances. And this seemingly like a non-objective task leads to these awesome, lots of these patterns and resilience, robustness going on. And I think this kind of epitomizes many things that are happening right now in the diffusion models space, in the open source creative community. So I think this is something that it really resonates with what's going on in the machine learning space as well. So if we talk about machine learning in particular, like generative AI algorithms, the collective intelligence or like a collaborative generative AI is not something that's so new. Even back in 2007, Ken Stanley published a paper called Composition Pattern Producing Network, or CPPNs, which are like a method to evolve neural networks that can generate patterns. And what he did back then was he put this algorithm on the internet. So back then when there's no JavaScript, but it was based on Java applets, and he let it loose. So Ken Stanley and his collaborators put this CPPN algorithm on the internet, and users started to evolve networks that generate these cool patterns. And what is interesting about these networks is some user can take some of these networks and continue to evolve them in some way. So they can kind of innovate and build on top of them to generate other algorithms as well. So this leads to more and more complex but interesting patterns being discovered by like a community of users around this platform, which he called a pig breeder. So when I first got into machine learning around 7 years ago or 7 or 8 years ago, I played around with this CPPN algorithm as well. I re-implemented it in JavaScript. And this is kind of how it looks like. You evolve a network on the right. You feed in the X and Y and the distance from the center coordinate. And the network outputs the RGB value, the color. So in principle, this can generate very high resolution images because you're not confined with about how many pixels you are. You just put in the coordinates. It could be any coordinate you want, and you get a color. And as these things complexify, I was able to generate very complicated images that look kind of cool. And this was back in 2015. And like when GANs or CIFAR-10 was at 32x32 resolution, and I thought it was kind of cool to have a neural network generate 2048x2048 pixel images back then. So when I got into deep learning, the first thing I did was to apply this CPPNs to MNIST, because I was sick and tired of MNIST. It was like 28x28 pixels. It's so uninspiring and low resolution. So I immediately used these methods to generate 1,000x1,000 pixel images of MNIST even. And also evolving all sorts of abstract patterns using these CPPNs. So I was fascinated by looking at what has been created from this sort of a collective or communal AI algorithms and how they can be applied to deep learning. And later on, when I joined Google, and I also worked with a team called the Google Creative Lab, and they also built something very inspiring. They built a viral game called QuickDraw, and they collected basically the collective knowledge of how to doodle things on Earth using a QuickDraw game, where basically they have around like hundreds of categories, and users were asked to draw things, doodle things in 20 seconds that resembled that category. And somehow they collected hundreds of millions of images. For some reason, people were addicted to or really enjoyed playing with neural networks. And this is a theme that's kind of recurring right now as well. People like to have an interface to work with an artificial neural network just to see what happens with that artificial neural network. And they like to get that feedback from that artificial neural network so they can play a game again. It's kind of like what's happening now with diffusion models, but that back then it was a lot simpler. And here, you know, the Google open sourced the data sets of like tens of millions of these doodles, and it was pretty awesome. It was like the first large collective data set of doodles all around the globe. And you know, of course, me, the first thing I did was I took this data set and trained a generative model on it. I trained an algorithm, a recurrent neural network called SketchRNN that can take doodles and continue to draw them so you can draw things like continue to draw gardens, faces, and insects, and buses, and so fire trucks, and so on. And I really like playing around these models interactively, just like how now when people use diffusion models, you like to have a very short feedback between seeing the output, typing another prompt. Back then, I made these models work in the web browser, so you get instant feedback. So after you finish drawing, the machine will take over right away and show you what's going to happen next. And I think this short feedback cycle is really important for machine-human HCI when we're trying to get people to creatively interact with these algorithms. I started playing around with extending this to multiple inputs so that you can sample different seeds. Like how when you're using diffusion models now, you don't just generate one, you want to generate 9 or 16 and choose the best stuff. So this is kind of like back then, you want to generate a lot of these and get inspiration from as many randomness as possible. And just like now, back then I also tried to open source these models and release it for everyone to use. And it was just amazing to see how the community took apart all of these neural networks in the wild. And one of the things I saw was that people deployed them on robots, and they were drawing doodles of cats and birds, and even someone took the SketchRNN model and projected some outputs to a building, and you know, like, that was pretty cool. What was really interesting back then was that even in 2018-2019, there was a student at Berkeley, Forrest Huang, who actually looked at QuickDraw data set and SketchRNN and used the concepts of prompts and put them into embeddings. And he had a paper that took a short text description and tried to create a doodle based on this description. So this is a very rudimentary version of modern text-to-image, but it was text-to-doodles. And I think one of the things I liked was that doodles were really simple, so he didn't need that much resources to train this model and able to you know, like, test out these early versions of text-to-image algorithms. So of course, 3 years later, the world has completely changed, but I thought this was a pretty cool work back then before text-to-images really took off. So around that time, I was working on many research problems, and fast forward a few years, you know, just from April of this year, when OpenAI, Google started demoing their text-to-image models, I had fantastic experience playing around with text-to-image models. You may look at my Twitter, and my Twitter feed was full of these examples. So I really like to play around with DALL-E 2 and ImageGen at the beginning. When I started using DALL-E 2 and ImageGen, I knew this was going to be a game changer. It's going to change the world. Like I actually thought they were a bigger deal than pure text generation models like GPT, because somehow the human perception system, the visual system is so attached to our senses, to our inner self, that we feel a lot more motivated and have a stronger emotional response when we look at the images compared to reading text. And I think that there's two types of initial applications, that people were making arts using these models, and also making photos of weird stuff, like a photograph of a strawberry frog. And what was really weird, it seems it was only this year, but it seems like such a long time ago that, like, remember back in April, only a small minority of people had access to DALL-E 2 or ImageJet. I remember back then, it's not like now everyone can download Stable Diffusion or whatnot or get invites to Midjourney, but like I was only a handful of people in the world who had access to DALL-E 2 and ImageJet. And it felt weird. It's like there's only a small number of users. And I felt like something was weird and kind of wrong, because I think this amazing technology should just be available to everyone. But you know, I had access to it, so I played around with it. And I started off making images, like many of you, with known artistic style, like having cyberpunk digital art or making Banksy images of Totoro. And then I tried to create some images with some degree of realism, but it's kind of like a fantasy, like the robots, romance, or beers, like bears drinking beer and eating ramen in Shinjuku. This was kind of cool. And then you can try to create some images with some degree of emotion, which is possible because of a diverse data sets and embeddings. And you can have like, you know, robots dating, or cats trading on a stock market, and so on. And what captivated me about these models is their ability to learn abstraction. So one of my motivation on the earlier sketch RNN and quick draw experiment was I wanted to understand how humans, like ourselves, develop abstract concepts of things. And then we doodle very simple representations of those things. But somehow these models can just learn that. Like, we can ask the DALL-E 2 to create a minimal line drawing of New York City, and it does that. It can create like Lego figures of Jay-Z, Jeff Bezos, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and Rihanna. And it has to kind of learn some abstract representation of Rihanna or Jeff Bezos or Jay-Z to make Lego figures from them. So I think these are pretty convincing examples that they're able to learn abstractions. I post a lot of these images on social media earlier this year, and I kind of monitor some of the engagement. I noticed that the images with the highest engagements are often not the ones that look the most beautiful or realistic. Like good art doesn't get retweeted that much. It's the ones that have involved cultural factors or kind of memes. So like one of the my favorite one is this photograph of a bear stock market in the 1930s. As you know, this year sucked for stocks and everyone's losing money. And you know, I tweeted that out. And the fact that the bear market got interpreted as a bear, and then the market was actually going down, you know, made this image with this kind of a misinterpretation really popular. And Bitcoin was also tanking, and somehow was like people like Japanese art. So Japanese Yukio-e scrolls with Bitcoin was also a trending thing. And these models were also great at making novel combinations of very distant concepts. Like, no one expects Darth Vader to be on the cover of Vogue magazine. And maybe no one expects, like, maybe some of you, but Darth Vader at a tech conference. You know, maybe he's trying to pitch some deal in a bad market environment. And one of the things that really shows the brilliance of the community is the ability to reverse engineer closed models. Like, I'm sure many of you know that DALL-E 2 has some the safeguards or like limitations, or where you can't type in profanity. And some users, not me, like type things like, you know, fuck you and get Elmo to generate that as a text image. It's kind of funny. And people also reverse engineer how the system was inserting prompts into the algorithm. So they had a prompt that says a person holding a sign that says, and then suddenly there will be a sign that says female or black as a way to de-bias some of the images. So the community is pretty smart. Humans are pretty smart as a group to figure stuff out. So by June of this year, I was thinking, what's next, right? These are pretty amazing stuff. At that time, I was thinking, was the future of text-to-image models dominated by big companies like OpenAI, Google, who have the resources to train bigger models on bigger data sets? And there's a plot twist. In the middle of this year, there's a huge spike in the usage of this model called DALL-E Mini. So DALL-E Mini is a community effort funded by Hugging Face, I think it's a hackathon by Boris and led by Boris, and they tried to reproduce Daddy One, and they were successful. You know, they created a model that can generate stuff from text, generate images from text. It's not a high resolution. It's like 256 by 256. And Hugging Face served this model on the Hugging Face Gradio or whatever the demo, and it became a viral hit. What was amazing is at some point this year, Daddy 2, not Daddy Mini, became an absolute viral internet meme. Like, you know, we're on ML Twitter and ML Reddit and so on, but none of that matters. Like much broader than that, people actually like associated text to image with Daddy 2. And many people were kind of surprised by that. But it turns out that Daddy 2, because of the low resolution and the 3x3 grid, is great at making memes, like, you know, M&M as an M&M. It actually makes an M&M as an M&M. So people loved it. It gotten so popular at one point that the New Yorker made a cartoon that featured this iconic 3x3 grid on the tweets. And it was written up on Newsweek, because you're able to make funny images of Trump and Biden using Daddy 2, which was probably prohibited from Daddy, using Daddy Mini, which is probably prohibited from Daddy 2. So people even made a meme for this Daddy Mini. Like at the beginning, Daddy 2 was rolled out to a selected group of artists. But then at the same time, people started using Daddy 2 to make minions at cross-burning, Jar Jar Binks at Nuremberg trial, and do things like gender reveal 9/11. It's kind of funny. And I think when Daddy 2 came out, it really offers a hint of creativity of the masses being unleashed. And this sort of a casual creativity is something that's really apparent in these text-to-image models. Like people can take these concepts like gender reveal and make Death Star explosion gender reveal, funeral at Walmart's, or neurosurgeons putting ramen inside a man's head as a joke. And it would generate it, and it's hilarious. And I think, you know, what made these viral is it's not just about scaling the model size or compute. I mean, that's important to get some quality, but just as importantly, I think the success of Daddy Mini is about scaling the number of human users and developers that's using this stuff. Like, there's like an evolutionary approach. People play with this model and upload their favorite ones, and the community will upvote the ones that they think are the most popular, and hence you get these meme images that come out on top. So, and what's also apparent at the time, many of you know now, is like what works on one model does not work on others. Like when you type in YouTuber doing a funeral unboxing on Daddy Mini, it's pretty funny stuff. You get this like, you know, tech bro unboxing like a funeral, like a coffin. But if you put the same prompt in Daddy 2, it doesn't really work, right? So these images, the best images are actually a result of not just the model, but a complex feedback loop between a human or the community of humans and a neural network model. So another thing that made Daddy Mini popular is because it can be used to portray cultural items to reflect current issues. Like, you know, this year, people generated a Fisher Price my first hand grenade, or Supreme Court dressed as clowns, and you can probably, it's self-explanatory. And when I was discussing this with my collaborator, Judy, I think like this, we think there's many, we can distill it down to three processes. There's the motivation to share. So after exploration, using a text to image model, people want to share them. And through sharing the images in multiple variants, you get some feedback from the network that you share it to. And think people build on top of it. So there's really, we think there's three stages in this framework. There's an individual exploration stage of using the tool or the model to create an artifact. There's a drive to share, and there's a network of dynamics that will allow people to build on top of your innovation, just like the pig breeder experiment or CPPN experiment I discussed at the beginning of this talk. And then you get the feedback back to the user. So, the first is mainly enhancing the person's ability to efficiently explore a wide space of possibilities, like individual exploration. There's also the model or the the framework or like text image models basically heightens a person's drive to share what they have created with other people. Maybe because text image models is just so new and cool. People just want to share these things. Maybe it won't be the case in 10 years from now, but probably not. And number three, the important thing is unlocking the feedback dynamics that accelerate innovations across large communities. So you share them and you get feedback, whether on social media or whatnot. And an example of these is like these innovations in the model are learned and passed on other users and are built upon. Like people discovered that Daddy Mini was good at drawing sketches of courtrooms. So on dinosaur, and people copied this concept and made a bottle of ranch dressing testifying in court or alien appearing in court for damages caused by abductions. So these are pretty hilarious. We discovered that PlayStation is pretty good as well. Like Grand Theft Auto Tiananmen Square edition and American Psycho for PS2. So this is only one part of the puzzle, I think. So there's the individual creator or artist using these tools. We also think this framework can be applied more broadly. In this space, there's the users and creators and artists using these text-to-image models or AI tools to create artifacts. There's also the developers that are working on these models or new ways to use these models or applications and hence creating applications as an artifact as well. And also, sometimes the artist can also be the developer, so they can wear multiple hats. But there's also, these two layers of loops going on, and not just users, but also developers. So I'm gonna talk about this part using Stable Diffusion as a case study, where we see things like creative applications, model hackers, and research. And boy, we can step from Dali Mini to the Stable Diffusion community. It's basically going from AI memes to AI arts. Like, I think I have 5-10 minutes left. It's okay. So the Stable Diffusion community is not just satisfied with text image. They want to create arts and fantastic images from it. And boy, this community is weird. Like you get on the left, like the model hackers that want to really make things look perfect and kind of criticize every single flaw. You get the normal users that just wants to make memes like Paris Hilton and Albert Einstein, you know, being wet to each other. And you also get the developers, like people hacking on Dream Booth to make pictures of their friend's wedding. So I'm going to talk about these three categories and of this loop. So in the area of creative developers, because the model is open source, it led to things like, you know, like hundreds of apps like Photoshop, Figma, Blender, people were writing plugins for all of these apps. And it's really difficult for one company to build plugins for everything. You really need a community of hundreds and thousands of developers. Like within days of Stable Diffusion initial launch, people built a Figma plugin that you can just use the Stable Diffusion model, type in a text prompt in Figma, and you would get like a realistic looking design from a text to prompt and conditioned on an SVG drawing or like a rendered SVG drawing. Blender as well, people were able to quickly develop plugins, or various plugins for Stable Diffusion for Blender, because Blender is the open source standard tool for creating 3D scenes. People are able to take these like renderings and 3D wireframe images, type in a text prompt and make them into various, you know, art pieces using Stable Diffusion. And like the other part I was talking about is the model hackers. There's so many model hackers out there. And this community really discovered novel ways of using Stable Diffusion. Things like negative prompts, how to combine models, fine tuning to model distillation. Like I think negative prompts, I'm not sure where it was discovered, but it was certainly made popular in Stable Diffusion. And you type in the prompts that you don't want to see, and suddenly it makes your burgers look much better. We can chain together Dali Mini to Stable Diffusion models, because maybe Dali Mini creates more meme images, and you can create a higher quality version of gaming toilet made from NVIDIA RTX 3090 GPUs. There's also a whole bunch of hackers making fine-tuning custom models, using Dreamproof or other techniques to customize models or on a particular data set. And this is something only possible with open source models, because with a closed source but very large model, it probably doesn't know who you are, or probably doesn't know any some niche concept, where like you actually want a smaller model that's good enough, and you can just fine tune it on your small data set to have a diffusion model that's suitable for your particular application. And what's funny is people actually try to get Stable Diffusion to generate styles that look like Midjourney by simply collecting Midjourney images and fine tuning Stable Diffusion model to mimic the prompt to Midjourney images, and you can kind of get Midjourney. They kind of discovered the concept of model distillation, rediscovered it by fine tuning Stable Diffusion into Midjourney data. That was kind of cool. And then lastly, I think I'll go 2 minutes left. I'll talk about how I think open source diffusion models like Stable Diffusion will become a foundation of the research community. There's so many works right now that's actually using Stable Diffusion as the benchmark model to communicate results in the academic community and in the research community as a whole. Like, for instance, there's this amazing paper called Dreamproof. Many of you may have used it to fine-tune your Stable Diffusion models. It came up by this fantastic group from Google Research. I know everyone here. And it was originally written to be used with the ImageN model inside Google. But right now, if you say Dreamproof, people will automatically think that you're using Dreamproof with Stable Diffusion, because it's what works out there and because of the open source model. Another recent cool work is this Instruct Pix2Pix, written from Tim Brooks and his collaborators at Apricot. And they were able to combine GPT type model or language model with Stable Diffusion to be able to create to instruct the model how to edit the images using natural language. And I think these are things that are easily doable with an open source model compared to a large closed source model. Even in the area of interpretability in machine learning, people are using Stable Diffusion as a base when communicating the results. Like, they're using, someone wrote a paper on interpreting Stable Diffusion with attention maps and so on. And I think Robin may talk about this later in his talk, but we think that Stable Diffusion is also going to become a popular model of choice for machine learning researchers working with diffusion models. And we think that the base model to conduct research on will become something like Stable Diffusion or an open source model, because precisely it's open source. We actually think Stable Diffusion will probably become something like a VGG or AlexNet model in the academic and industry ML research community, because people can communicate and speak in the same language. And even lastly, some areas outside of ML research, like health, are using Stable Diffusion. There's a paper called RoenGen. Someone built a team built a generative model by fine-tuning Stable Diffusion on a large X-ray and radiology report data set. And they're creating new, generating new X-ray and radiology images using modifying the text prompts. I'm not sure whether how impactful that is, but this stuff is going on. And I think, I don't want to go out of time, but I think this is just the beginning. And I think with the trajectory of this open source and community-led development, both on the user side, on the developer side, and the research side, the future is going to be really bright. So I don't want to go out of time. Thank you.
There we go. Hey, so thank you so much, Eric. It's an awesome talk. I think maybe the most number of actual memes I've seen in a talk, so really, really cool. We've got a few questions from the audience if you've got a few minutes.
Sure, I don't want to go over time because I think maybe we're still under time.
Given that you can take a few questions just to see. So there's one here.
Yeah, maybe you can choose one or two, and I can answer them.
So the first question is from IQ Mates, who's asking, as these models become more capable, how do we protect against deepfakes? And I think this is like a really important question that is on the mind of, you know, everyone worried about generative AI.
I think so too. Like there's many opinions out there, but my opinion and my view is like we should release these models as frequently as possible to the community. And I think that the community at large will be able to look at the dangers of these models or preventing deepfakes and looking at the dangers collectively and finding ways to mitigate them. I think this approach is much preferable than having one institution taking the responsibility of protecting the model, because there's so many instances of history where like that doesn't work. Like look at cryptography and so on. Like while these models are not that like perfectly realistic, generating, you know, hands or six fingers, I say just release them, put them out there, get people to work on safety aspects collectively. And I think that the red team has to be in the open source world as well, to work together with the model development team to push forward. Otherwise, you would just end up confining a model inside an organization and it'll never see the light of day. And that model will eventually be leaked somehow, or people will reproduce it once it's very high quality, and the community will not have enough time to develop the protection against it.
Yeah, that's totally agreed. I think also at Hugging Face, this is something that we're very aligned with about, you know, doing things in the open, right? Because what we learned also in NLP is that when you have open source language models, people can actually inspect them and, you know, attack them, which is cool, right? I mean, it's not easy to do through an API.
Yeah, totally. And as I discussed in the last part of the slides, the interpretability research are using stable diffusion models as the base model.
Yeah.
So this is actually happening right now.
Cool. So maybe we can take one more question, which is a bit of a eye to the future. So will text to GIFs or text to videos become the natural extension to the sort of current family of generative models, or is this still a difficult problem to solve?
I think it's a natural extension. Like if you follow the literature, Google has already published an Imagen Gen video work, and that's pretty awesome. You know, I used it when I was there. You know, it works. So we're already there, and it's only a matter of time when these results get reproduced by the community at large and extended upon. And then, like, hopefully, the way I approach research or we approach research as stability AI is not necessarily just reproducing stuff, but we want to be able to innovate and optimize for efficiency, like where you don't actually need like a TPU pod to run these models, and we want to make sure that maybe you need a decent GPU might work. The quality might not be state of the art, but at least people can try to make GIFs from it.
So exactly. Kind of great. I think it was you who said on Twitter that like the metric today is like, can it run on Colab? And then how many images per second? It's like,
yeah. So it's a multi-objective optimization, I think, when we're making these models, and we just gotta get the best bang for the buck.
Awesome. So maybe we can end the broadcast there. So thank you so much, David, for joining us. It's been a real pleasure.
Thank you.
We really enjoyed the talk. And to everyone else who's in the audience, we're going to take a break now, and we'll be back.
Okay, so that brings us to the end of the Diffusion Models live event. And sorry for those audio issues. It's not so easy to stream a recording on StreamYard. Thank you to everyone who's joined for all the talks and for all the questions. I'm pretty sure the speakers have had a nice time, talking about both their work, but also interacting with you all. And just a reminder that we have a Diffusion Models class that we're doing with Jonathan, and we have several units coming up in the next few weeks. So if any of the things you saw today are exciting to you and you'd like to learn more, I suggest you check it out. And we're going to put all these videos up on YouTube later, probably next week. And you'll be able to then, you know, rewatch them, and we'll have details to all the speakers and where you can, you know, follow them and so on. So thank you once again to everyone. And it's quite late for me right now. So good night. and see you at the next event. Bye.